It's one of the most storied and anticipated games in the Ivy League, the most played rivalry in the Ivy, Yale and Princeton, with a lot on the line today. Hi, everybody. So glad to be with you alongside a guy who's played in a number of these rivalries, Jack Ford, a former Bulldog. I am Bill Spaulding. This is a game that we circled on the calendar all the way back when the schedule came out. And now we get to week 9, Jack, and there is a lot in terms of Ivy championship that matters out of this game.
This is a league often known for uncertainty. Only 8 teams in the league, no playoffs. This year, that uncertainty could morph into something akin to chaos. Yale has control of its own destiny, wins today, has a share of the title, wins out next week against Harvard. The title belongs to Yale alone, but there are a lot of other folks in contention.
Yeah, here's a look at what comes out of this game. You just mentioned it. Yale controls its destiny, and to win today would end an 11-year title drought for the Bulldogs. That's the longest in school history. Princeton can stay mathematically alive and keep that possible scenario where you could have 7 teams share the championship. Here are the standings after Dartmouth's win yesterday. They're alone in second place behind Yale. But you see the hodgepodge from Dartmouth all the way down to Princeton. All those teams alive with just 2 weeks left in the season. One of the reasons Yale has been so good this year is they've had a freshman, Zane Dudek, who has just burst onto the scene. He's averaging close to 9 yards a carry.
They knew coming in that he was talented. They didn't know how good he was going to be at this level. As you mentioned, 9 yards a carry, number 2 in the nation, and he gives them a weapon anywhere on the field.
On the flip side, Chad Knopf, senior quarterback. He's on the Walter Payton watch list as the best player in FCS football. Just a stellar quarterback.
He is leading the league in almost all the passing categories, and a lot of folks look at him, 22 touchdowns, big body, big arm, saying he could end up in an NFL camp.
That should be so much fun. Princeton has one of the best offenses in the country. Yale, one of the best defenses. The 140th chapter of this Princeton-Yale rivalry should be a great one. Kickoff is coming up next.
The Ivy League means extraordinary. A conference that stands alone as the purest form of student athlete. A conference focused to compete nationally and created to inspire globally. It's 8 schools combining Division I athletic excellence and academic prestige, and a community of greatness that inspires lifelong connections and successful leaders of tomorrow. Why not be extraordinary? It's the Ivy League.
At Princeton Stadium, one of the most storied rivalries in college football. This is the second most played rivalry in college football behind Lehigh Lafayette. This will be the 140th meeting, and started all the way back in 1873. I don't think that's a live photograph. That's an artistic drawing of that first meeting. My favorite story from 1873, the ball was kicked. It exploded. It took them 30 minutes to find a new football. And through the years, we had even more historic matchups. You were a part of this rivalry as well, Jack.
Yeah, play here a number of times in the old Palmer Stadium here, which was one of the great football venues in the country. This new stadium that they put up a number of years ago is just a fabulous building. But you look at some of those pictures, and you look at the crowds that they used to draw for these games. It was astonishing how big it was nationally.
Let's take a look at some of the keys to the game here for Princeton and Yale. And Jack, let's start with Yale. You think there's any chance they're overconfident coming into this game?
Well, knowing Coach Tony Reno, I don't think he's going to let them become overconfident, but you've got to realize this. As we said in the top of the program, they're the ones that have control of everything now. They've had some good wins. They know that Princeton is coming off 2 tough losses. So what Yale has to do and what the coaching staff has to do is make them understand, we're not done yet. You still need to get through this game.
You mentioned the tough losses against Penn. Princeton had a touchdown taken off the board in the final few seconds, a pass that on review looked like it was caught, was ruled incomplete, and the Tigers lose by 3. Bob Sorace, they bounce back this week because they're treating it like they won that game against Penn.
Yeah, you talked to Coach Sorace during the week. I talked to him today down on the field. It was a heartbreaking loss for Penn. It looked like they scored a touchdown with 5 seconds left, would have essentially won the game for them against Penn. It would have allowed Princeton to be in contention today here still for the Ivy title. So what he has to do is make sure that they can put that behind them and they can say, all right, there are still some scenarios here where we can come out on top. We can't let what happened last week dictate what happens this week.
You see Bob Sorace, the Ivy League Coach of the Year last season, in his 8th season as Tiger Group, one of the most talented in the league, coming off those 2 really close losses, and they'll look to bounce back and change the Ivy championship picture. for Yale, Tony Reno, who has coached on both sides of that Harvard-Yale rivalry, which is the big game next week for the Bulldogs. He's in his sixth year as head coach, and he said he's never had more fun than coaching this current group of Yale players.
You know, he's talked about that. You and I have spent a lot of time talking with Tony Reno, and he's talked about the fact that they have now the guys that they want. It takes a number of years, as you know, recruiting years, to get in not only the character football player, but also the quality of a football player. And one of the reasons why they've been so successful, Bill, is they have some extraordinary depth this year. Not just depth, but quality depth. But Tony's happy with the ability for these players on the field, but he also loves who they are off the field.
Princeton won the toss, chose to defer, so Yale's offense will get the ball first, and that means we'll see Zane Dudek, who is on the Jerry Rice Award watch list, which goes to the best freshman in FCS football. Dudek also sometimes returns kicks, though it looks like today, going back to return, will be Caden Herring, who's been returning kicks the past couple of weeks. Next to him is Melvin Rouse, a wide receiver, running back, hybrid player, two youngsters for the Bulldogs.
You saw the energy already at the coin toss. The entire Yale team comes out onto the field, jumping up and down. You got the same kind of reaction from the Princeton team. So obviously these guys are ready to play.
Kicking off from the 40 in Ivy League play. Touchbacks come out to the 20 instead of the 25. The 140th meeting between Princeton and Yale is underway with a booming kick from Tavish Rice into the end zone for a touchback. So Kurt Rawlings will lead this Yale Bulldogs squad out onto the field. Rawlings, a sophomore, already a great leader. Tony Reno told us this week that Rawlings' teammates would follow him into the middle of traffic during rush hour on I-95 through New Haven if he asked him to.
And I think in some ways that Coach Reno was a bit surprised just because of the fact that he is indeed a sophomore. You usually don't generate those types of leadership qualities and the leadership power that Kurt Rawlings has.
Doesn't give it away much. You see that touchdown to interception ratio, 16 touchdowns, just 5 interceptions. First play for the 4-1 Ivy, 7-1 overall Bulldogs. Underneath, Christopher Williams. Lopez has first down yardage on a gain of 11 yards. Williams Lopez, part of a very good wide receiver core for Yale, and they have a great offensive line. O-line's given up just 8 sacks all season long.
They have been proud. Coming into the season, they knew this offensive line was going to be one of the focal points, one of the strengths of their team, but I think they've exceeded even what the expectations were in terms of their efficiency.
First carry for Zane Dudek, bottled up and going nowhere. A gain of just 1 for a Princeton defense that is very banged up. That's a great start against Zane Dudek.
It's a good start for them. You know, you talked about banged up. They've lost 6 or 7 starters for the season here. They've had to fill in the gaps, if you will, with guys that Coach Saray said were literally on the scout team just weeks ago. But based upon that, first, they're going to focus on Zane Dudek. They're going to try to keep him boxed in, and the essence is going to be for the defense. Don't let him get around that edge.
Here goes Dudek again, tunneling forward for 4. So he entered the game with 889 yards on 99 carries. That's a 9 yard per carry average. 2 carries, 6 yards to start the game today.
Good start so far for that Princeton defense. You often hear them talking about the beleaguered Princeton defense, but so far they're showing that, at least with a sample size of 2 plays, that they've got some idea how to keep Zane Dudek under control.
First third down of the day for the Yale offense. Struggled on third down at just 35% this season. Delayed blitz coming. Rawlings down the sideline, incomplete. Blanket coverage from Chance Melanson on Michael Siragusa, one of Yale's top targets. Bulldogs forced to punt on the opening drive.
Has to make Princeton happy with that. You can see Kurt Rawlings has the time to deliver the ball. Works one-on-one on the sideline. Good throw, but better defense.
Now Princeton's defense given up an average of about 30 points a game over the past couple of weeks. Start strong here. Punter is Alex Gallen to do it all for Yale. He punts, kicks, and sometimes handles the kickoffs as well. On top of that, he plays the trumpet in the Yale marching band and plays the anthem before Yale home games.
How about a real student athlete? These are the two teams composed of real student athletes.
Bulldogs take it back with Tiger Besh on the return. Besh is slippery and up to the 35 It's an 8-yard return for Tiger Besh. And we'll see the Tiger offense that leads the Ivy League in basically every statistical category, led by Chad Knopf.
You watch him in the pocket, and he had a great year last year, but I think this year he has elevated his game. He has such composure in the pocket, even when there are guys on him. But part of that is the fact that he is, as we mentioned at the top, he's a big kid. And he has the ability to shed tacklers. He has not only a big, strong arm, but he can surprise you with his legs.
Leads the Ivy League in every statistical passing category. Play action on first down underneath Tiger Besh. There's the Princeton single-season completion record for Chad Knopf. His 225th puts him into first place on the Princeton list. Has a great core of wide receivers as well. You just saw Tiger Besh. Jesper Horsted and Stephen Carlson are two of the best in the conference as well.
Two very big receivers. Those guys are both 6'4 and can go up and get the ball.
Here's the speedster Charlie Volker going nowhere against the interior of the Yale defense. Spencer Mathai, the defensive tackle, made the play, and Yale's strength is up front on defense.
Coach Tony Reno told us they run about 10 different guys in on a regular rotation, not just occasional substitutions. And he believes it's allowed him to keep the pressure on throughout this game. What Yale defense is going to do, they're going to pressure you up front, and they're going to come after you, press man-to-man coverage on the edges.
Yale leads the Ivy League in points allowed, fifth nationally. Pressure coming. Pocket holds. Knopf finds Stephen Carlson for first down yardage. That's what Princeton does best, Jack. Princeton leads NCAA FCS football at 54% on third down.
So you combine that percentage, and a lot of that is a result of Chad Knopf completing 75% of his passes. They love to run those under routes, about 8 or 10 yards.
Volker into the teeth of the defense, going nowhere. Kyle Mullen stands him up after a short gain of about 2. Chad Knopf at the top of so many different categories in the Ivy League and in the nation. Again, leads the nation in completion percentage. And he's leading by a pretty big margin ahead of Jake Mayer out of UC San Diego. Pressure coming. Knopf hit up in the air. Carlson got a piece and knocks it down. Stephen Carlson, the wide receiver, taking it away from Hayden Carlson, the Yale safety.
That gives you an idea of the talent on these Princeton receivers. Carlson goes up there. This should have been an interception, except for the fact that he's 6'4". He can jump out of the building, and he's smart enough to become a defender on that play.
Brings up another third down. Best third down offense against the Ivy League's second-best third down defense in Yale. There's the smart senior Knopf changing the play before the snap. Knopf over the middle behind Tiger Besh. He had him open for first down yardage. Rare miss for Chad Knopf. And Princeton will be forced to punt on its opening drive.
Chad Knopf talking to Tiger Besh as they come off the field. He obviously wanted him to be doing something else because he was fairly animated talking to his receiver after that play. Again, you're talking about a guy who completes 75% of his passes. That one looked like it was just misthrown, but apparently there was some miscommunication between the quarterback and the wide receiver.
Jason Alessi back to return the punt. Yale has used Alessi to return punts the past 3 seasons. Princeton has gone through a couple of different punters, including the quarterback, Chad Knopf. And it's Knopf here booting this one to the 15, hopping inside the 10. That is perfectly done. Killed at the 4. It's a 46-yard punt. Yale backed up. Both defenses come up with early stops.
It's a bonus re-air of Yale football on a Saturday as we look back at the 2017 Yale-Princeton football game. And I'm pleased to be joined by a very special guest, and it's the head coach of the Bulldogs, Tony Reno. And Coach Reno, the 2017 Princeton game, that clinched at least a share of the Ivy League title for the Bulldogs.
It did. It was a wild game. I mean, it was crazy from the start, and it was really an example of that team in 2017. You know, a team that had a battle in a few ball games at the end of the season to win and, you know, clinch a share of the title that week, and then eventually clinch the title outright the following week. You know, I think every time we walk in that stadium, you were ready for an incredible football game. And, you know, Yale and Princeton have had such a great history of great football games. And, you know, for us, we played a wild game there in 2015, the last time we were there. And it was very similar ending where it went right down to the wire and we were able to close it out with a Morgan Roberts touchdown pass to Rob Clemens. But this game was kind of the opposite, where we needed to close it out on defense.
And when you look back at this game, the defense gives up a lot of points in the first half, and the offense was some big plays late in that second quarter.
It was. I mean, defense had been – we were the number one defense in the league and one of the top defense in the country going into that game. And give Princeton credit. I mean, they did a really nice job of executing in the first half against us. And, you know, we faced, you know, some of the biggest deficits we had all season in that game. And finally we settled down in the second half defensively. We were able to play much better. But our offense really was the story for us in the first half. And at the end of the first half, we were able to climb out and had a huge play at the end of the first half. And then really to start the second half of the game, Princeton received the kickoff and we forced a fumble on the first drive. And, you know, we capitalized on it and scored right away.
Can't talk about this 2017 Princeton game without looking at the big defensive play that sealed the deal for the guys, and that was Foye Luikin with an interception to put the stamp on the game for the Bulldogs.
It's true. I mean, you go into that game, there were three guys who really made game-changing plays for us there. Not to belittle anyone's other performance, but Ross Strahl, senior wide receiver, had a huge touchdown reception. Jaden Graham, senior tight end, had a huge touchdown reception. And then to close it out, Foye Luikin had a play on an interception that was forced by another senior, Matt Opplinger. You know, Matt ran the edge on a blitz and, you know, just basically picked up their tackle and drove him into the quarterback. And Foye picked the pass off. And I think everybody in the stands on the Yale side was yelling at Foye to get down. But as we see every weekend on Sundays, he likes to run with the ball in his hands.
And, you know, we've talked a lot about this 2017 season through the course of our re-airs this fall. And we talk a lot about how the young guys that played in 2019 were a big part of it. But this class, this Yale class of 2018, those seniors just made plays all over the field all season long.
They were a really special group, a really selfless group. I mean, they've instilled some of the values that we carry today with our players, and the culture. They were bought into the culture from day one, and they made an incredible impact on the team. I mean, you got guys like Hayden Carlson and Jason Alessi. You know, Spencer Majeski was a captain of that team in the fifth year. And, you know, we talk about Matt Opplinger and Ronnie Meter on defense, and, you know, it's just, you can go down the line, defensive line, offensive line, every position had a group of seniors that were just such tough, resilient football players, but also like incredible examples of what we want for Yale men playing football.
Coach, just one more week left in the season, one more game left for this 2017 crew, and we can't wait to talk about it next week when we talk about the clinching of the championship for Team 145. Coach, thank you for your time.
Thanks, Ed.
It was Yale coach Tony Reno looking back at the 2017 Yale-Princeton football game. So Bulldogs and the Tigers, and it continues now.
Pressure coming from the outside. Pocket holds. Dudek out of the backfield. Picks up 6 yards to set up third and one off another sharp completion from Rawlings.
Another element that Zane Dudek gives you, the ability to come out of the backfield. He's got exceptional hands. You can see this right now. Kurt Rawlings takes a snap. And Dudek is not his first option, but Kurt Rawlings checks down to him and says, fine, we'll take that. Puts us in a situation now where third and less than one for a first down.
Rawlings has hit on 4 of his first 5 passes. 3 first downs already this drive for Yale. Dudek gains first down yardage, just lowering the shoulder and pushing the sticks. 2-yard gain for Dudek. who is the feature back for the second consecutive game after splitting time all year with Deshaun Salter, the senior Salter injured against Columbia and done for the year.
It's a shame for Deshaun Salter because he was having a magnificent senior year, and he has been plagued by season-ending injuries throughout the course of his career. So, yeah, was very sorry to see him go down.
Back-to-back blowout wins for the Bulldogs, 23-6 over Columbia, 34-7 last week against Brown. Rawlings has all day. Deep shot, Christopher Williams-Lopez, incomplete. Strong coverage the whole way down for the Princeton Tigers safety, Ben Ellis.
Princeton has been hurt in their first two levels, their defensive line, their linebackers, and it's put a lot of pressure on the back end of their defense. But the corners and the safeties have really done an exceptional job stepping up. You saw great coverage there. Good throw by Kurt Rawlings, put it out where only his receiver could get it. Just a little bit too far for him, but great coverage by the Princeton defense.
You mentioned the injuries for Princeton. Five defensive linemen on the two deep out for the year. One of the top tackling linebackers, Mark Fassati, out for the year. Yet here they are, 5-3 on the season. Dudek, patient, churns ahead on 2nd and 10 to gain 6 yards and set up 3rd and short.
What you have to expect from Yale is this. They know that Princeton is keying on Zane Dudek. They're bringing guys, their linebackers are about 2 steps up. They've got safeties creeping up into the box. And what Yale is hoping for is in one of these scenarios, they'll get that play action, get the linebackers to step up, get a safety to move, take a step on a read, and then spring something deep down the field.
Yale's 1-for-2 on 3rd down today. Princeton's defense has struggled a bit to get off the field lately. Just 44% on defense on 3rd down this season. Dudek on 3rd and medium is drilled, going nowhere. Thomas Johnson, the leading tackler, a junior middle linebacker, sticks him.
Now, it's an interesting call, and what it suggests is that Yale is looking, might have been looking at this as 4th down territory, but Tony Reno has thought better of that. You see the kicking team coming on. But again, it gives you a sense of the confidence that the Yale offense is on 3rd and 5 or 6, which is sort of long for most teams. They're going to try to run Zane Dudek up the middle. They have a stretch play there. He was waiting for the defenders to extend one way so that he could plant and cut back the other. But once again, we saw Princeton staying in their lanes, playing disciplined defense.
Looks like the Tigers run blitz, too, and really shot the gap. Gallen trying to pin Princeton back. That is perfectly done. Measured down inside the 10 and batted back. So the ball's officially killed at the 11. That was almost how you draw it up exactly. To the gunner down the sideline. Princeton takes over next. Still 0-0.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
With Jack Ford, Bill Spaulding, let's throw it down to the third member of our crew, Seth Cantor, who's bundled up on this chilly day down the sideline.
It's actually not as bad as I thought down here, Bill. Like you said before, 140th meeting between the teams, playing since 1873. That's when Ulysses S. Grant had the presidency. Anyway, Yale does have the advantage. In fact, before the overtime rules, there were 10 ties in this series. You talked about the ball bursting. How about in 1882 when Princeton's James Haxall drop-kicked a school-best 65-yard field goal to give the Tigers a 2-1 win? The teams have split the last 8, and no team has won more than 2 in a row.
All right, thank you very much, Seth. Jack, what are some of your best memories of playing in this Princeton-Yale rivalry?
We came in here in 1969, and a team that was probably one of the best coaching jobs legendary Carm Cosa did. It was a year after one of their great teams, led by Calvin Hill and Brian Dowling, upset Princeton and ended up winning a share of the title for it.
Second drive today for Princeton. Tiger offense has scored more than 200 points over the last 5 games. First down handoff, Charlie Volker gains just a couple of yards. Well, mentioned your playing days, Mr. Ford, back in the day, graduating in the early 70s from Yale. You recognize any of that?
Yeah. It seems like a long time ago sometimes, doesn't it? But we had some great rivalry games with Princeton here, although I must say in 4 years that I was at Yale, we never lost to Princeton, and we make sure we mention that to all of our Princeton friends.
I know you have a couple family members who played at Princeton as well. I'm sure that comes up at Thanksgiving. Knopf down the seam, finds Jesper Horsted. He slips a tackle, and he may go. The Ivy League's leading receiver all the way to the house. 89 yards. Touchdown, Princeton.
That's what these talented wide receivers give Chad Knopf. We talked before about the fact that Yale's a pressure defense. They come after you up front, and they press you man-to-man outside. You can see they just gave him a little too much room. Safety, wrong angle for the tackle. Jesper Horsted is just a fantastic athlete. Look, he's 6'4 and 225 pounds. He's running away from the Yale defense. In addition to a great football player, he's also a great baseball player here at Princeton.
That reception takes him over 1,000 yards this season. In the long history of Princeton football, they played in the first ever football game. He's only the third Tiger with a 1,000-yard receiving season.
I was astonished to see that figure.
Tavish Rice on to kick the point after, and he bangs it right through. So against the first-place team in the Ivy League, it's Princeton's offense that strikes first. 89 yards from Chad Knopf to Jesper Horsted.
The action is just getting started in our re-air, the 2017 Yale-Princeton football game. And we have another special guest for today's show, in this class of 2020 defensive back, Tosan Agbeyegbe. And Tosan, my first question for you is really the most important one. Why Yale?
Growing up, my parents always stressed the importance of academics. And for those who don't know, actually, I was born in Nigeria. And when I first played football when I was 12 years old. So kind of a combination of my parents stressing academics and me wanting to play football in the States, as we call it in Canada, kind of led me to look at the Ivy League as my go-to conference that I wanted to explore. So I remember talking to Yale coaches before coming to camp, and then summer before going into my senior year, I went to camp and immediately got an offer, and I immediately shut down my recruitment. My parents didn't even want me to look anywhere else. I personally didn't want to look anywhere else either. So it was kind of mutual want. Yale wanted me, I wanted to be at Yale, and it was immediately that was the goal.
So when you came to Yale, this was the first time that you had lived in the United States.
I lived in Nigeria until I was 9 years old, and then I lived in Canada until I was coming to Yale. So yeah, being at Yale was the first time I had permanently been in the United States.
We talk about Team 145, and it's just an incredible group of players. And defensively, you all had a veteran-led group, especially at your position in the defensive backfield. How important was that senior leadership in 2017?
We had, I believe, three of our guys. So Hayden, Carlson, Jason Alessi, and Spencer Mrzeski. We had three starters who were all seniors who all, they always kept us in shape and in place. Spencer was obviously a captain, and he was always – he came to every meeting, every practice, every game, prepared the way he needed to. And he was the one that kind of set the tone, and Hayden and Jason Lessie kind of kept that tone going. So I remember it was always me, Hayden, Jason Lessie, Brendan McPhee, Will as the safeties. And we all would keep communicating with each other, whether it's coming out the field, hey, what are we running? And we all, we could play both safety positions. Same thing at corner with Spencer. He was always keeping the corners in check. So it was kind of a trickle down effect. It was always the older guys were always setting the tone, and we just followed them, and they set a great example for us, especially over the next 2 years after that.
Looking to this 2017 Princeton game, you all are in the middle of a winning streak, but Princeton got off to a fast start. What was the mentality of the team after the Tigers built their big first half lead?
Yeah, so I remember coming into that week, I think Princeton had a lot of injuries, but we didn't let that kind of deter how we were planning for the game, obviously because they had the same system, and even those who were replacing their injured guys were just as good. I believe we went into halftime, I believe it was 24-14, and we were just, we scored a touchdown after, like I said, we went down 24-7, and we kind of just felt like the momentum was going our way. And even on defense, we made our adjustments schematically, but we also just talked about, hey, like, they've given us their best punch. We've, for lack of a better word, we've survived their best punch. So now, we have to go back on the field and show, like, why we play defense, or, like, how we play defense the proper way. And they only scored one touchdown in the second half, so because the game ended 35-31. So we never went down, even when it was 24-7, which I think was the biggest lead. There's no shouting. There was no pointing fingers. Like, we gave up a couple of long touchdowns in the first half. And it was always get back up, what, next play. Figure out what went wrong, figure out why we did it. We knew we could be in a position to make those plays. We just have to make them. So,
when you look back to this 2017 season, was there a particular moment that stands out to you from Team 145?
Honestly, I would say it was the game we lost against Dartmouth. And not to be cliche, because we were 3-0 before that game. We were up 21-0, I believe, in that game. Obviously ended up losing 28-27. And it was like, I almost want to say any other team that might have broken them. We were up 27-14 going to the fourth, or with like 5 minutes left in the game. And any team could look at that and be like, okay, we deserve to win. We had this call go against us. But no, we came back out the next week and we shut out Holy Cross. And it was then they were like, okay, like, we as a group, we knew that wasn't us. As a group, we knew collapsing that way was never going to happen again. And it's because of that we were able to come back against Princeton, or we were able to keep in mind that, like, hey, we've been in this reverse position before, and we don't want that to happen to us. So we want to do that to another team, in this case was Princeton. So I'd say that was a good point. That was a good turning point lesson for our team, that, like, we knew what it was like to be up big in a game and let it slip, but we also knew what it took to come back in a game if we were down big.
As a Yale football player, you know that the last two teams on the schedule are going to be your two biggest rivals. What does that end of the season mean to a Yale football player?
It's definitely the Harvard game is our big. Like I said, Harvard is our biggest rival, and additionally Princeton. In terms of preparation, we always looked at it preparing as the same we would for any other team, because we. We didn't want to ever deal with any drop off. We didn't want to let the extra crowd throw us off. We always approached every team in terms of preparation the same way. I guess as a player, the biggest thing, or the biggest difference when you're playing Princeton and Harvard, is that you know more people are looking at you. There's more eyes on you. Every other mistake you make is magnified a little bigger. But it never changes how the team looks at each other. So. Again, a mistake against Princeton is treated no different than a mistake against Brown. A mistake against Harvard is treated no different than a mistake against Columbia. Everybody has to be held to the higher standard possible, because to beat Princeton and Harvard, you have to be at those higher standards. Again, and those lessons and those qualities came out when we played Princeton in 2017 and when we played Harvard. We ended up being 9-1 at the end of the day.
That was Tosan Agbeyegbe, defensive back and member of the Yale class of 2020. Don't go anywhere. The Bulldogs and the Tigers continue now.
Get the first down.
That injured player down for Princeton. It's Nico Bayless, an outside linebacker. And again, the front seven has been shredded with injuries already this year for Princeton. Losing Kurt Haluba, first-team All-Ivy Leaguer, Jay Rolader, Joey Percival, Matt Hampson, Mark Fassati, and now down goes Nico Bayless.
That image of a Princeton player down has become all too vivid and painful for this Princeton team during the course of the season. You mentioned some of the guys that have gone down and have missed appreciable time, many of them missing the entire season. So this has been a mash unit for this Princeton team. And I was down the field beforehand, and the guys who were not dressing to play were sitting on the bench. It looked like you had an entire team sitting there.
Of course, they've also been without John Lovett, the Ivy League Player of the Year last year, for the entire season.
Star first team All-American
quarterback who combined for 32 total touchdowns last season. Touchdowns running, throwing, and receiving.
It's astonishing they could lose somebody that talented and productive and still have the offense that they have.
Another first down for Yale. Rawlings, pocket closes, down he goes. Sack will go to Anthony Siragusa, but you have to give a lot of credit to the Princeton secondary.
Princeton putting pressure on just with four players there. Dropping the rest into coverage, doing a good job. You can see Kurt Rawlings stepping up in the pocket, looking for somebody to drop it off to, and just too much pressure from Princeton. Good job by the Princeton defense.
It's a big game for Anthony Siragusa. His brother Michael is the starting wide receiver on the opposite side for Yale.
A couple of Ohio boys, a couple of Cleveland, Ohio boys playing against each other. You can see Kurt Rawlings has the time. Nobody's open. Steps up. Pressure comes from the outside, and Princeton's able to put him on the ground. One of the few sacks that Yale has given up all season long.
Just the ninth in nine games. Rawlings underneath for Shofi. It's a decent gain to make it third manageable. Give J.P. Shofi eight more yards. You mentioned nine total sacks now. Tony Reno told us during the week of the previous eight sacks, he put three on the quarterback. So he said his offensive line's really only responsible for five sacks all season.
It's interesting when you have the coach stepping up for his guys saying, all right, let's not count that on them.
It is an amazing offensive line, which we'll dive into more during this season. Maybe even more amazing for what they've done off the field this year. Brings us to the end of the first quarter, and right now, first place Yale finds itself behind, but moving the football. Jesper Horsted's touchdown, our lone marker in quarter one. 7-0 Princeton. Nothing. Princeton leads. Tigers, the defending Ivy League champions. Yale can clinch a share of the Ivy League championship with a win today. Our coverage of Ivy League football may be going just one more season, but remember, Ivy League sports will cover all year long with basketball and hockey this season. Tune in with us weekly to watch live coverage of men's basketball and men's hockey from prestigious schools in the Northeast. With Jack Ford, Bill Spaulding, let's say hello again to Seth Cantor.
Well, Bill, Jack, you mentioned Jason Garrett earlier, probably the most prominent Princeton football alum in the NFL for 15 years. Garrett has held his annual Play It Smart football camp. He's routinely used Princeton Stadium. He hosts 300 underserved high school students every year, not only teaching them about football, but giving them leadership skills. And this year, Cowboys quarterback Dak Prescott was one of his featured guests.
Very much, Seth. And the Garrett family, of course, so entrenched here at Princeton. Chad Kanoff is passing Jason Garrett in a number of different career records throughout the course of this season. Yale football third down to start this second quarter. Bulldogs have moved it but haven't scored yet. Screen pass for Dudek is bottled up. Boy, that's great coverage from Khalil Bryant, a senior who's moved into his starting role at defensive end.
Khalil Bryant, you can tell, just sensed that play. That's what you need to stop screens like that. Watch him. He sees where Dudek goes, and he just feels it. Actually gets his arm on him and just stays right with him. You know, that's what you need, because ordinarily the offensive linemen are letting the defensive linemen come to set up that screen, but he had a perfect read to shut that one down.
So for the third time today, Alex Galland is on to punt. It's a chance to pin Princeton back. Princeton showing pressure here, and it's coming. Gallen gets it away. Tiger Besh lets it bounce inside the 10 and down to the 4. A 44-yard punt. Alex Gallen's had a great start. Princeton's backed up once again. 3-0 Princeton on the coldest day of the Ivy League football season so far. Temperature was just about 36 degrees at kickoff. But the players aren't thinking about how cold it is. This is a huge game for the Bulldogs and the Tigers. Princeton can stay alive in the Ivy League race with a win. Yale locks up at least a share of the Ivy League title with the win today, and that's important because Yale has gone 11 years between championships.
Tell me about it. We've anguished through 11 years of no championships, but you can see there how everybody, with the exception of Brown, in some way, shape, or form, is still alive.
There is a possibility for a seven-way tie, and it might sound crazy, but I can spell it out for you pretty quickly. What would it need to happen this week? Penn would need to beat Harvard. Cornell would need to beat Columbia, and Princeton would need to beat Yale. Well, right now, Penn leads Harvard. Cornell and Columbia are tied 0-0. Princeton leads Yale, and then that would keep that a possibility heading into next week, where there would be one distinct scenario that would again need to happen. But it's not completely crazy that there could be seven-way co-champions this year. Third drive for Princeton. Charlie Volker charges ahead and moves the pile for 3 yards. It was just a two-play, 89-yard drive last time out for the Tigers. Jesper Horsted going 89 yards off the pass from Chad Kanoff.
Princeton running up-tempo now.
Yeah, moving quickly over the middle. There's Horsted again on the slant. He's been matched up with Yale captain Spencer Rimashevsky, who's a great cover corner all day, but there's been no one in the league able to slow down Horsted.
You realize you're talking about, again, as we said before, a 6'4", 220-pound wide receiver with great hands and exceptional speed. That's a tough chore for anybody, including a first-team All-Ivy corner like Spencer Rimashevsky.
It's Horsted in motion. On play action, Kanoff finds Stephen Carlson, his second option for a big gainer. This drive started at the 4. 3 plays later, it's up to the 43.
That was such a clever offensive play. There's so much going on. Look, you see guys crossing in the backfield. What they do is get the attention of the safeties, who end up coming up and out, and it leaves the middle of the field wide open. And as we've seen, Chad Kanoff, if you give him a little bit of time and a little bit of space, he's going to complete that throw.
Kanoff underneath for Cody Smith. There's a rare incompletion. Chad Kanoff's completed 75% of his passes this year, which is a ridiculous number. And aided by one of the best halves of football ever played by an Ivy League quarterback, he started the Harvard game 20 for 20 for 320 yards in the first half.
I mean, 75% is like a 7-on-7 game.
Volker, a draw on second down, bursts forward. It's a good gain, 7 yards for Volker, who is the Ivy League sprint champion of the 60-meter dash at the Heptagonal Championships. You saw that flash of speed there.
He was one step away, and you could hear the Princeton crowd gasp knowing his speed. He was the state of New Jersey all groups state champion in the 100 meters, so he has legitimate speed.
Here's freshman Colin Eady through the seam forward. Eady gains the first down. 4-yard gain for Colin Eady, who's paired up with Charlie Volker all year. You see Volker's numbers. It's been a good season, but maybe not a great season yet for Volker, who's still waiting to find that space. He's told us he's aware that sometimes he runs to contact when he's faster than everybody and he needs to just break away.
You don't have to prove you're a football player. Yeah. We know you're a football player, but we also know you're a football player with speed, so get to the edge and turn it on.
Over the middle, Carlson covered well, Malcolm Dixon, and the flags do not come out. We still have not seen a penalty yet from this Ivy League crew. Tight coverage from the sophomore Dixon.
Coach Bob Cerace walking down the sideline, gesturing to the official that Dixon, according to Bob Cerace, you can take the look there, had hooked him with his right arm. Now again, you can get your right arm on a player, use your left arm to knock the ball down, as long as you don't turn him with that arm or impede his ability to receive that ball.
Underneath Ryan Quigley, another one of the Princeton running backs, cut down by Matt Opplinger. Senior linebacker Matt Opplinger, second nationally, 9.5 sacks this year.
Matt Opplinger has been a force since he showed up as a freshman. Yeah, he ended up starting at linebacker as a freshman out of one of the powerhouse programs in New Jersey, the Del Barton School. And he is just, Coach Tony Reno told us, he is so intense and such a leader on that field. He's developed far in excess. They knew he was going to be good. They didn't know he was going to be this good for this league.
Sets up another third down for the top third down offense in the country. Princeton 2-for-3 on third down today. incomplete. Bounced just in front of Hayden Carlson, but fourth down's coming, and the Tigers will punt.
Take a look at this again. Chad Kanoff has time. And this has been the best part of the Princeton offense so far. Obviously, they had a great long gain for a touchdown, but they've been able to keep this Yale defense essentially off of Chad Kanoff. And there's not another team in the Ivy that's been able to do that so far. And if you give him time, again, he had a couple of drops and a couple of good defensive plays in the last two drives, but if you're going to consistently give him that much time to deliver the ball, he is going to hurt you.
Here's Steven Mejia on to punt. Jason Alessi calls for the fair catch and makes it down at the 12. Both offenses have moved the ball to midfield effectively. Still just one touchdown to show for it. Yale next.
You can make it if you try.
Nothing. Princeton over Yale. First place Bulldogs with the football again. Reminder, coming up today, it's a full day of football on 11 sports. Immediately following this game, we go to Boston and Fenway Park as UMass takes on Maine as part of the Gridiron Series. Then finish the day out west for the Big Sky Conference between Montana State and Northern Arizona. All coming up on 11 sports. With Jack Ford, I'm Bill Spaulding. There was an Ivy League game up at Fenway Park yesterday. Dartmouth taking down Brown. It was freezing, 20 degrees, gusting winds in Boston yesterday.
And Fenway is a great place to be, except maybe when it's cold and windy.
Quick hitter out of the backfield to the outside for Christopher Williams. Lopez stays in bounds and dips ahead, and out comes the first flag of the day after what would have been an 8-yard gain. For the first time today, we get to hear from Michael Sechrist, the Ivy League referee.
Looks like they're going to get either a hold or a late hit on Yale as just as that play was wrapping up, which is, again, one of those things that drive coaches crazy. Looks like the play is almost over, and the flag comes out.
Holding offense. Just foul. Pete, first down.
I believe that was on Connor Fury, the tight end, who's trying to create some space for Christopher Williams-Lopez.
So you can see it's going to happen right at the end here, which is going to allow them to get credit. Again, it'll be a spot foul right there. Well, I'm not sure where they called that one.
It might have been on that play that was coming into your screen at the very right. End with at Fury, the tight end,
very
coming
end
over.
Again, but the tail end of the play, yep. Which coaches will say, look, block to the whistle. But don't hurt us with a silly foul at the end of the play.
Spot foul, so it's first and 13 for Yale on its fourth drive of the day.
85!
Here goes Zane Dudek. And he can't make the first man miss. Hit first by John Orr and cleaned up by Chance Melanson, the quarterback. It's been a total team effort to slow Dudek down today.
You really can't overstate how good this Princeton defense has been playing here. And you saw once again the idea of playing with your eyes, staying with your reads, not overrunning the play. And these are guys that have not had a lot of experience this year, but they're doing exactly what the defensive coordinators needed them to do to hold him in check.
Here goes Dudek on the sweep. A little bit of space, lowers the shoulder and gains four. Third and six coming for Yale. Bulldogs have gained about 120 yards of offense, but have stalled out on each of their first three drives.
You and I were talking before, the game is basically being played between the 40s, with the exception of the one big play, the touchdown play for Princeton.
Yale averaging 35 points a game this year. They've won four straight, lead the Ivy League at 4-1 in the league, 7-1 overall. Struggling early today, though, against Princeton. In a rivalry series that has seen a lot of crazy endings between two of the oldest programs in college football. Third and six. Rawlings over the middle, threw it behind his intended target, J.P. Schofield. For the fourth time, Yale will be forced to punt.
You talk about in this rivalry, And we can take a look here now. Kurt Rawlings. Princeton just has been rushing four guys. So Kurt Rawlings has had time, but the coverage has been exceptional back there. Linebackers getting back into their lanes. Safeties being where they're supposed to be. Ball was a little bit off by Kurt Rawlings, but still good pressure and good defense by the back end of the Princeton defense.
Should be a chance for Tiger Besh to return here. Besh makes the first man miss and plunges ahead to the 46. Best field position of the day for Princeton, right near midfield.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
7-0 Princeton Tigers in the best field position of the game coming up. Reminder that this game and all our Ivy League football coverage on 11 Sports USA is live on Twitter at 11 Sports USA. 11 Sports for the fans. With Jack Ford, former Yale Bulldog, Bill Spaulding, pleasure to be with you. Seth Cantor is down on the sidelines as well. Tigers have started three drives from inside their own 20. Now they start at the 46 with the football and a 7-0 lead. 88-yard touchdown from Chad Kanoff to Jesper Horsted, our only score today. The freshman Colin Eady ripped from behind, and out comes a flag.
Well, it looks like it's either going to be a horse collar or a face mask, because he seemed to change direction awfully quickly there, and he saw the official throw the flag immediately.
Personal foul, face mask, defense, number 96. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run, automatic, first down.
That's Kopachi Tyler, the All-Ivy League defensive tackle, called for the face mask. Add 15 yards to the 3-yard gain, and Princeton's in business near the 35.
Talked before about the fact that with the exception of that big play, which was generated by a broken tackle, they've been slugging it out between the 40s. Now, as you mentioned, Bill, all of a sudden, Princeton's starting to move the ball and getting into range.
It's remarkable what could have been this season for Princeton. 1-point loss and 3-point loss the last 2 weeks. Here's a pitch out to Eady before Yale's defense was set. First down yardage on a 12-yard gain for Colin Eady. And a smart call by Chad Kanoff to get that snap off.
You know, so often you see teams, they don't huddle, they line up, but they look to the sideline. This time, they're lined up where they're looking to the sidelines, or Yale's looking to the sidelines. They snap the ball, get that quick pitch out, turn the edge, and turn it into a big-time game.
Snap it quickly again as Eady just pushes the pile forward for 70 yards. Eady was recruited by Yale. Tony Reno said, we really liked him as a running back. Could you imagine if Eady and Dudek together went to the same school?
There are not enough footballs, I don't think, but those guys. Eady, true freshman again, as with Zane Dudek, and Princeton thinks he's going to be another one of their real good ones as he develops.
Play action cut off over the middle. Touchdown, Princeton! Steven Carlson pulls in his 10th touchdown this season.
What you see on this is the play fake holds the linebackers and it gets the safeties to just move a little bit. You know, when you have that mid-level slant, in order to be successful, you got to get the linebackers out of the passing lanes, and you got to influence somehow the safeties so that he can run free the way he did there. So great fake by Kanoff set up that touchdown.
24th touchdown pass this year for Chad Kanoff. Tavish Rice on for the extra point to put the Tigers 2 touchdowns ahead of first place Yale. 14-0 Princeton off to a hot start against the Bulldogs.
Take a look at the replay here, and you'll see the fake right there. Enough to hold the linebackers, and just to, and you see there's no safety. The safety was on the right. He doesn't get over to help. It is tough to ask these corners to cover these two big and fast wide receivers, especially when they're running slants like that in the middle of the field is wide open. So good design on the play by Princeton. Great execution. The fake of the run is just enough to hold them, and a good delivery, as we've seen all season long, by Chad Knopf. So 14-0, I don't think anybody would have expected this.
Jack, we told you Jesper Horsted had moved into a tie with Derek Graham and Roman Wilson, 11 touchdowns at the top of the Princeton chart. Steven Carlson keeping pace. He's now pulled in 10 touchdowns this season. Not bad for a guy who had two catches over his first 2 years here at Princeton.
You know what it shows? It shows good coaching and the ability of the coaches to recognize players' talent and players' ability to say, all right, I'm going to work hard till I get to the point where I know that I can deliver. And I think Carlson is a perfect illustration of that, a guy who rarely was contributing and now is on the verge of breaking records for Princeton.
Tavish Rice to kick it away. One touchback so far. This is returnable. Caden Herring starts forward. Stays on his feet. He's out to the 24. Decent field position for Yale. Let's take a look around the Ivy League in the penultimate week of the Ivy League season. Everybody basically still in the mix coming in.
You're doing Harvard. Ivy League, so you can use words like penultimate here, Bill.
Penn 17, Harvard 6, Columbia 3, Cornell nothing. Again, if you're rooting for that total chaos scenario of a seven-way tie, you like what you see in Penn-Harvard. Penn would need to win that game. Cornell needs to beat Columbia for that to happen, but that game between two teams with just two losses in Ivy play, very close one early.
Interesting scenarios all over the board here.
Again, Yale with a win today would clinch at least a share of its first Ivy title in 11 seasons. You're a Yale alum. You said it's been tough. It's been a long time.
Long time. No Ivy titles. It was a long time drought against Harvard, which we broke last year.
Rawlings down the seam. Wide open. The tight end, Jade Graham, is into Princeton territory.
You can see Jaden Graham open from the time he left the line of scrimmage. I don't know if it was a blown coverage or if it's just something about the call. So you can see Kurt Rawlings looks right down the middle, right down the seam. And you saw Jaden Graham split the difference between a linebacker and a deep safety.
That's 27 yards from Rawlings to Graham. Run! Now here's Dudek. Big seam. First time today, Dudek is free. Down the sideline. Zane Dudek all the way. Touchdown, Yale! 47 yards. It was only a matter of time.
That is exactly what the Yale fans have been looking for. It's what we talked about at the beginning. Watch this. Again, patience. Zone blocking. Finds the seam. And once he finds the seam, a straight arm there. And now it's all a matter of speed. It looked like Princeton had an angle. The question was, some of the Princeton folks were saying that he stepped out of bounds. You can look right here. Keeping himself in.
Now, he did lose the football heading into the end zone. There is no replay review in the Ivy League, so that touchdown stands.
Right. And once that ball crosses that line or hits the pylon, that's a touchdown. So we saw the Zane Dudek that we were expecting to see. It's to see elusiveness, good vision, and then speed to finish the run.
Now he's up to 88 yards on 14 carries on his route to a career day in terms of carries. 14-7, Yale's back in it. Again, no replay review, but if there was, let's take a look at this.
Look at that left foot, tough to tell. And again, as you said, Bill, extends the ball out.
Now, it seems like he fell back on top of it in the end zone, and it stayed in anyway.
But even he had, I think he had possession of it as it crossed the line. And it wasn't as if it was a pass where you had to take it to the ground to complete the catch.
That's the 12th touchdown this year for Zane Dudek, who leads the Ivy League in rushing yards. He's set the Yale freshman record already. He leads all freshmen nationally in rushing yards. And he is closing in on 1,000 for his season with those 88 yards. He's now about 30 yards shy. And if you'd believe it, the Ivy League hasn't had a 1,000-yard rusher since the 2014 season when it was another Yale Bulldog. A tremendous season for Yale's Tyler Varga, who rushed for 1,423 yards.
Tyler Varga had one of the great seasons for any, not just Yale running back, but Ivy League running back. 5 touchdowns and a win over Army. Made the roster with the Baltimore Colts. Going down to, let's try the Indianapolis Colts. Made the roster.
Back when you were playing in this rivalry with the Baltimore Colts.
Yep. Exactly. You know, made the team and was injured and is retired from football. But they talk about Zane Dudek, and you look at what his ability, he's been mentioned mentioned now, he is on the watch list for the FCS Freshman of the Year. So you've got two watch list players on the field in terms of Chad Knoff for the Walter Payton Award and now Zane Dudek for the top freshman in the FCS.
That award named after Jerry Rice, the Jerry Rice Award for the top freshman in FCS football. It was a slow start. Now we got it going. Two of the top teams, two of the most talented teams in the Ivy League. In the 140th meeting between these two prestigious schools, one-score game. This is returnable for Tiger Besh. Very short kick. And Besh has some space to the sideline at the 30. Tiger Besh gains 25 yards on the return and gives Princeton good field position again.
Could there be a better name for a Princeton football player than Tiger Besh?
I will answer that question with a big bold no. I don't think you'll ever find a better name.
How could you even get recruited by another Ivy school when your name is Tiger? But showing again some of his
Princeton
versatility.
Or LSU or a number of other schools with the Tiger nickname. Yep.
Well, I think in the last two drives, we saw what we expected to see. The air game, if you will, of the Princeton offense and Chad Knoff, and then the ground game of Yale, the Yale offense with Zane Dudek.
Knoff's thrown for 154 yards and two touchdowns today. Back at it again with this top-ranked Princeton offense. Knoff fumbles the football. Oblinger's coming. Ball is out and blown dead. Incomplete. Yale still looking for that first sack. They have 33 sacks the first eight games. And their leader, Matt Oplinger, almost got there.
And I think one of the storylines so far has been the ability of the offensive line to protect Chad Knoff. That was a perfect snap. He just mishandled it. He was looking for his receivers, mishandled it. That could have been a disaster for Princeton. Luckily, they called it an incomplete pass.
Here's great catch for Horstead, snatching it out of midair and gaining the 43. This is close on the spot, and it looks like it's short by half a yard for third down.
When you look at the hands of Jesper Horstead, and he's such a talented athlete. We mentioned a great baseball player here at Princeton, major two-sport accomplished athlete, Division I. You just don't see that often. He was the Minnesota High School Athlete of the Year his senior year in high school.
All-Ivy baseball player as well as a guaranteed All-Ivy wide receiver this year. Volker on third and short, charges ahead. This is what we talked about. He might be the Ivy League sprint champion, but he's a power runner, and he ran through contact there.
When you look at him, Volker, he's a big kid. He doesn't look like a sprinter who's playing football. He looks like a football player who happens to be really fast.
And there's Jesper Horstead. He plays center field for Princeton. He's a guy who can go get the ball out there in center. 306 hitter. He hit 320 as a freshman. Knoff with all day to throw. Going deep for the tight end, Adam Midas. He's got it, and he stumbles down inside the 20. There's a flag out on the other side of the field in the defensive secondary.
An area where you'd expect to see holding. It was away from the play.
And Tiger Besh ended up down on the field, so I think it was defensive holding. And here comes the call.
Holding, defense, 21. That will be declined. There's all the play. First down, Princeton.
So a 36-yard gain to the tight end, Graham Adamidis, who nearly was gone.
Again, look at the pocket that he has. He's able to step up. You know, interesting thing, quarterbacks will oftentimes, when they're stepping up like that, thrown off of the wrong foot, overthrow that ball. But Chad Knoff put it exactly where it needed to be.
On first down, Knoff throws incomplete. Just trying to dump it off to the left side. The ball ended up in Yale hands, but it had hit the ground first.
But that was just a good defensive play by Yale, a stay-at-home defensive play, because they had everything moving to the right, and they were trying to drag something back across to the left. There was one Yale player who, but fortunately for Yale, he read it perfectly and broke up the pass.
By the way, for Adamidis, his season long before that 36-yard catch was 11 yards. Here's Ryan Quigley, the sophomore running back, charging ahead for 5 yards. Sets up third and five inside the red zone for Princeton. Yeah, it's coach speak, but Bob Sray said this week against Yale, it's particularly true. Got to score touchdowns in the red zone. They've settled for field goals some the past couple weeks.
And it's been important to Princeton to come back after the Yale score, to try to reestablish themselves here.
How about Yale's red zone defense? The best in the league. They've given up just 8 touchdowns on 20 trips to the red zone. On third down, Knoff dumps it short. Quigley pulls it in. First down, Princeton.
You talk about Knopf and how big he is, the big-time arm that he has, but there you can see his movement, his ability to extend the play. He can tuck it in and run. There are some, as a matter of fact, they have some running plays designed specifically for him, but that was just a function of finding some space, let the play run out, and then find his receiver.
Volker bouncing to the outside, slices back in, down to the three. 6 yards for Charlie Volker, who has scored 11 touchdowns running the football this season.
Showing the patience we talked about before. You know, a lot of times guys that have that tremendous speed don't necessarily show that same type of patience. But Charlie Volker has evolved over the years, and Princeton is very happy with what he has become in terms of a vision and patient run.
Volker off left tackle, pushing forward, and he's cut down at the two, so only a 1 yard gain. Third and goal for the Tigers.
It would be interesting if they don't get it here, whether Coach Bob Sorace decides, you know what, points are going to be important here. They're always important, but against an offense like Yale's, maybe more so. Interesting to see whether if they don't get it here, they decide to go for it on fourth down.
Princeton Bob Sorace out onto the field to take timeout. So the Tigers will talk things over. This is where last year during their Ivy Championship season, Princeton would have put John Lovett in at quarterback. He was a red zone superstar, 20 rushing touchdowns, 11 passing touchdowns, oh yeah, and a receiving touchdown as well for Lovett.
We talked about the idea for Princeton to lose somebody who is that productive, first team All-American. As you said, Bill, could score for you any number of ways and was sort of a guarantee for you when you got down in close to the goal line. And for them to have lost him for this entire season, now the question for a lot of the Princeton fans is, will he come back next year? Will he look to get the red shirt and decide I'm going to have another year here? But it would have been an easy call for Bob Sorace.
Yeah.
Last year, saying put John Lovett in and we got a lot of things that he can do for us.
Well, we just alluded to how important the red zone will be because Yale is as good as anybody in the red zone. You see this overall defense. Look at the defensive numbers for Yale. But in the red zone, they have held teams to 8 touchdowns in 20 trips into the red zone.
That's an amazing number.
Here comes third and goal from the 2. Princeton is 4 for 6 on third down today.
Overloading the right side.
That's Horsted in motion. Cut off, pop pass to Horsted. And he is bottled up. Rimashevsky, Chisholm, and Mathai combine on the Yale tackle.
I think they'll watch the film, and Jesper Horsted will say to himself, I should have kept it to the outside. We mentioned they had overloaded the right side of the field, put Horsted in motion from the left side, and then did the pop pass to him. He decided to turn it up, but it looked like if he had tried to extend it, that Princeton had the edge.
And that loss of yardage makes it an easy decision. Tavish Rice comes out to kick a 21-yard field goal. It's from a sharp angle, way to the right side. Perfect for Tavish Rice, directly into those two hands down the middle. Princeton by 10, still 3:07 on the clock for Yale. It's a really big drive for the Bulldogs because Princeton gets the football to start the second half.
And it was important for them also to rebound from that Yale touchdown. They gave up what they knew they had to protect, and that was the long run by Zane Dudek. But they took the ball and just methodically marched down the field using all of their weapons. Now, certainly they would have liked to come away with 7 down there, but being able to put 3 on the board in response to Yale's touchdown is a big thing for the psyche for the Princeton team.
Coming up at the half, we'll have first half highlights and analysis. And on this Veterans Day weekend, we'll also feature Mike Vitti and Dominique Rogers, 2 former college players who have also served in the military. They'll be discussing what their time spent serving our country meant to them and how they're able to pay it forward in college football. Mike Vitti, part of an Army West Point team that is having another really impressive season, 7-2, and at last check, they were leading Duke today.
Yeah, that's been such a great job by Army to put football back together again. Yeah, I did a story for 60 Minute Sports a couple years ago on the attempt to resurrect Army football. You know, they brought in a great coach, an energetic guy. It was a hard first year, but now they are the real deal, and Army football is, in fact, back. Army-Navy game this year should be fantastic.
Princeton leads Yale 17-7 after the field goal from Tavish Rice. Another chance to return for Melvin Rouse. Big crack up the middle. Rouse with a flag down. Burst to the 38. Likely coming back on what would be the third penalty against Yale.
Boy, it looked like, as you said, Bill, he was one stride away from stepping out of that tackle. But it would have been a bit heartbreaking if he took it to the house to turn around and bring it back.
Now, there were no penalties in the first quarter. This is the fourth time we've heard from our referee here in the second.
Receiving team, number 9, 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down, Yale.
That's senior wide receiver Michael Siragusa. So it'll back Yale up inside the 20. Boy, this was well blocked, too.
You can see Rouse has some speed, finds the seam. We don't see the hold there. What a great tackle to keep him from going farther.
Okay, so 3 minutes, 1 second on the clock. Yale still has its full complement of timeouts, all three for Tony Reno and the Bulldogs. Down 10 points. Yale's been a really good second half team, but you want to be within a score heading into that second half. Bulldogs first in the Ivy League can clinch a share of the Ivy Championship with a win today. Rawlings taking a shot on first and long for Shelfie, incomplete. Shofi got tangled up with freshman quarterback C.J. Wall. There are no flags.
Yeah, some people might be watching saying, how can there not be a flag? There was contact and he went down. Well, the contact was essentially, as you said, Bill, they just got their feet tangled up. It wasn't any conduct by the defender impeding the ability of Shofi to catch that ball, but it's unfortunate because he had two strides and the ball was out there.
That cornerback C.J. Wall, a freshman from Plano, Texas, he has been starting since the first week of this season. A lot of responsibility for him on this defense coordinated by Steve Verbit.
He has had a great season. I think looking at him as a freshman, he's become one of the top cover corners in the league as a true freshman.
Here comes Dudek off a 47-yard touchdown. And now he's starting to make some guys miss. He gained 6 there. So trying to wear down this Princeton defense.
And that's a good point, Bill, because this defense, this Princeton defense, has spent a lot of time on the field. And I think part of what Yale wants to do is get them worn down so that all of a sudden they're not following their eyes, they're not following their reads, they're overrunning plays, and the fatigue sets in. And when fatigue sets in, that's when a guy like Zane Dudek is going to take advantage of it.
93 yards now for Dudek on 15 carries. He's never carried the ball 20 times in his college career. This will likely be the day with Deshaun Salter out. Pressure coming on third down. Rawlings airs it out for the sticks, and it's bobbled just over the top of Graham. Shofi had it go through his hands. With 2:09 to go, Yale will have to punt, and Princeton should have good field position.
I'm not so sure that Jaden Graham didn't basically interfere, of course, not intentionally.
Yep.
But he comes flying across. It looks like he thought that ball was intended for him. You can see him going up in the air. I'm not entirely sure that he didn't interfere with the vision of Shofi, because the ball hit Shofi right in the chest.
Oh, and now Princeton's going to have another chance to score. 2:09 with two timeouts is an eternity for this quick strike offense.
This is not what Yale wanted. They wanted to at least run the clock. Ideally, they wanted some points, but they wanted to at least run the clock and not give it back to Princeton.
Wobbly kick from Gallen. Goes just 38 yards, and Princeton has great field position again at the Tiger 42, up by 10. Again, this game's important because Yale can clinch a spot in the Ivy League with a win. They can eliminate about half the teams that are still in contention with a win. Meanwhile, if Princeton wins today, there are going to be at least 5 teams that have a shot at an Ivy championship heading into the final weekend next week.
And you talk about the psyches of the team, Princeton is a must-win scenario. They have to win today to stay in play in the remotest sense. Yale, you have to worry that they're saying, okay, well, even if we don't win today, we still have another shot next week. And that's certainly what the coaches were worried about.
Senior quarterback Chad Kadoff going deep for Tiger. Bish, he's got it! Bish, all the way for 6. Touchdown, Princeton! 58 yards! They had 2 minutes, needed just 9 seconds. Jack, nobody has gashed the Yale defense like this season.
That is that quick strike ability that Princeton has shown often. Remember a couple of weeks ago, Bill, they took Harvard apart.
Yep. Scored 52 against Harvard. They had a 3-game stretch against Georgetown, Brown, and Harvard where the Princeton offense scored 155 points.
But as you said, nobody so far has handled the Yale defense the way the Princeton offense has today.
By the way, there's a big thing going on behind the play. Left tackle Mitchell Swigart's being helped off the field. Swigart, an all-Ivy Leaguer, and a player that Bob's Race said is going to get a shot to play in the NFL next year.
He's a big, talented guy, and he was down for a while after that play. Good to see him get up and at least come off the field.
No sacks from Yale yet, but if Swigart's not out there, that could really alter this game moving forward. Tavish Rice can make it a three-score game. And again, remember, Princeton gets the football to start the second half. Just getting away from Yale very quickly.
Princeton right now with all of the momentum in this game.
Princeton scored more points in this first half than Yale had given up over its last two games. Bulldogs given up just 13 points against Columbia and Brown the last 2 weeks.
I think he had a penalty. I think he had hitting the kicker on that also, which is going to be tacked onto the kick. You can see right there, Jason Lessie just misplays that ball fractionally. He gets his left hand up. I think he thought he probably had a hand on that ball. Tiger Best just keeping his eyes on the ball, running through the play. Another fantastic throw by Chad Kanoff.
Defense, that penalty will
be running into the kicker. So the penalty declined and they'll take the extra point. 24-7 Princeton. And boy, if you're Yale here, you have to treat this like a must-score drive. Minute 51 seconds to get back into this game.
You've got to come away with something. Right now, Yale is on its heels. This defense has not seen an offense like this before. Tony Reno said to us, this is going to be the best offense we're going to see. And they've been just taken apart so far. And the offense, just with the exception of that one good run by Zane Dudek, they haven't been able to do anything similar to what they've done in the past.
And
now, for Yale, they've been a very strong second-half team. But you still don't want to, if you go in behind 24-7, and all the momentum right now is on the side of Princeton, that's not a good way for you to start off that second half.
It's Tiger Besh's second touchdown of the season. He's a speedster, much different than the rest of the wide receivers. You can see how much shorter he is than the guys he's hanging around with. Princeton generally brings in 6'3", 6'4", wide receivers, but Besh is speedster. Under 6 feet tall, but with serious wheels, and he went right down the seam for that touchdown.
So I'm just run right through and take the top off of that Yale defense.
Well, you start to wonder what could have been for this Princeton team this season, defending an Ivy championship. Here comes Rouse. Hits the corner hard, and he's out of bounds at the 25. Again, remember, 2 weeks ago, Princeton led. Cornell kicked a field goal with 43 seconds left to go up one. And then Princeton missed a field goal in the final 5 seconds that would have won the game. Then last week in Philadelphia, Steven Carlson caught a touchdown. Should have put Princeton ahead with 5 seconds left. On review, it seems very clear that Carlson was in bounds. It was ruled incomplete on the field. There's no replay review. With a chance to tie it on a field goal with 3 seconds left, the field goal went wide. So two losses that very easily could have been two wins. That's why the Tigers are scrambling.
And not
to stay
desperation
in.
Field goals.
No.
They were easily makeable field goals that they missed.
Speaking of desperation, big drive for Yale. Underneath, Christopher Williams-Lopez gets himself out of bounds after a 10-yard gain. It's a good way to start the drive for the Bulldogs, who have scored just once on a long touchdown run by Zane Dudek.
Yeah, there's plenty of time. Minute 38 left. They have the ability to move this ball. We've seen them so far between the 30s moving the ball, but right now it's really important for them to get some points, get something on the board before this half is over.
Here's Dudek out of the backfield. Spins off a tackle and out of bounds to stop the clock again, about a yard shy of the first down marker.
His balance is just exceptional. You know, you rarely see him go down on a first hit. You'd see coming out of the backfield a ball that was not well thrown. He makes the catch, keeps his balance, gets them nearly to a first down, but gets the clock stopped, which is important for them right now.
Rawlings is thrown for 121 yards. We had Yale against Cornell early this year. They did score a big touchdown late in that second half that sparked them to a huge second half win. Rawlings down the sideline. There it is. Jaden Graham all the way to the house. Touchdown, Bulldogs.
Well, we talked about Yale had about a minute 48 to score, similar to what we talked about Princeton before. It took about 20 seconds to do that. You had a defender go down. The guy who had Jaden Graham fell. The quarterback saw it, got the ball out there. The safety was just too late coming over in support. So Yale doing what Yale needed to do to get back into this game, not just on the scoreboard, but to get their heads back into this game.
They always line up like they're going for two and then come out to kick the point after. Wait, did they leave too much time on the clock for Princeton's offense?
I was thinking the same thing. If I'm Yale, I'm thinking, oh, yay, we scored. Oh, no, Princeton gets the ball back.
Only took the Tigers 9 seconds last time. It only takes Yale 26 seconds to score here on a 58-yard touchdown from Kurt Rawlings to Jaden Graham.
You can take a look at this.
That was Princeton for T.J. Floyd.
Right, his defender went down about 10 yards before, and the safety just a little bit late getting over.
Now, as T.J. Floyd a hair behind, he went to undercut it instead of trying to make the tackle. Graham all the way 58 yards for his fourth touchdown. What an explosion we've had. It was 7-0 with about
this is what we thought we were
going to
be
saying. Quarter.
You know, on that last play, you're taught as a safety, you're the last guy there. You can't undercut that ball for an interception unless you're dead certain you can get your hands on the ball. Even if you can't catch it unless you can knock it down. So the coaches will say, look, if you give them a 20-yard completion, fine, but just don't play the ball unless you're certain you can go after that. Otherwise, we need you to be the one who's going to make the last tackle.
By the way, taking a look around the Ivy League, Penn still leads Harvard. It's 20-6 now for the Quakers. Another team thinking woulda, coulda, shoulda. All three of their losses came in either the last 5 minutes or overtime this season. Meanwhile, Columbia still up 3-0 on Cornell. Big Red have now gone almost three full halves of football without scoring a point.
It's funny, they were the comeback story. Everybody had them done. Just kind of left them for dead after the first couple of games, and then Cornell came storming back. But as you said, Bill, seemed to have dried up a bit.
And Yale can clinch an Ivy League championship, or at least a share of the title, with a win today. Here's Princeton's Tiger Besh breaking to the sideline. Flag is down as Besh is out to the 42. This will likely back the Tigers up. With a minute 16 seconds left and two timeouts. I would be surprised, even if they're backed up here, if they kneel on the football the way this offense can go.
At this point in time, you know, given what the season has been
during
so
the return, holding receiving team number 19, 10-yard penalty from the spot of foul, first down, Princeton.
If I'm Coach Bob Sorace, even though they're going to be back now, you know, in the 20-something instead of up close to the 40, given what they've done so far, I'm going to say, let's see what I can get on this first down. We can generate a pretty good, solid play on this first down. You know, then let's see what we can get after that. But if they get nothing, you might see them saying, all right, we're back down here. We don't want to make a mistake. But I'd be surprised. I mean, this is Chad Knopf's a gunslinger. I think Bob Sorace has had that attitude with his offenses since he's been the head coach. I'd be surprised if they don't say, let's try and put some points on the board.
They are throwing here on first down underneath. Besh can't pull it in. Four long touchdowns in this game. Every touchdown has been 47 yards or farther. All three Princeton touchdowns have been at least 58 yards.
We knew they were going to be explosive offenses, and that's exactly what they were. And right there is an illustration. Tiger Besh, great speed, great hands, but he's not as big as the other guys. The 6'4" guys may well have pulled that last ball down.
Cut off with all day, going deep for Besh. He's got him this time. Tiger Besh up to the 46. It's a gain of 22.
But that's what he does well. Basically, he doesn't have to be 6'4" to run good patterns, have the speed, found the gap, and Chad Knopf found him.
By the way, Brent Holders is in at left tackle right now for the injured Mitchell Swigart. So Swigart misses this series. 58 seconds to go in the half. Pressure coming. Knopf to scramble, and he gets back a couple of yards. Tigers have yet to decide to call the timeout. Clock winding at 45 seconds. A little bit surprising. Didn't call one of their two timeouts there.
Yeah, you would have thought they would use it there, then get lined up and have a couple of plays in your pocket.
Cut off. Down the seam. Incomplete. Under through Jordan Argue, the 6'2 junior wide receiver.
One of the first times Yale was able to get some pressure on Chad Knopf. They didn't put him down, but they got him to move backwards on the throw to try to escape from that pressure. And you could see he just underthrew that ball a little bit, which is what happens when you're moving backwards.
And we'll say it again. This is the first drive without star left tackle Mitchell Swigart. You've seen the pocket break down on two straight plays.
And that's an enormous loss for that Princeton offensive line.
Yale trying to take momentum into halftime, down 10. Knopf hit as he throws down the sideline, overshoots Tiger Besh, who's bumped into the Yale bench. Fourth down, Princeton will punt as the Yale defense holds.
Tiger Besh was wide open, running that wheel route coming up the left sideline. It's one of those situations where Chad Kanoff didn't have quite as much pressure. If he could have gotten rid of the ball a little bit quicker and stepped into the throw, that could have turned in. You can see this. Besh comes across the field, turns it up, just overthrows it. That would have been a perfect back shoulder come back to the pass if Kanoff had had enough time to step in and throw the ball.
Nearly blocked. Alessi calls for the fair catch at the 18. Decent punt from Steven Mejia. It goes about 37 yards. Puts Yale inside its 20 with 24 seconds left. You'd assume take a knee here.
Well, you would assume
maybe,
so.
Maybe.
But given what we've seen so far in this game, I'm not sure. Again, this might be one of those situations where they say, let's see if we get on the first down.
31 points this quarter combined after Princeton scored the only 7 of the first quarter. Now, this is not a victory formation from the Bulldogs. Kurt Rawlings in the gun with Zane Dudek next to him.
They like to run out of this. They put three guys on the left side. They like to get a stretch zone scheme.
Throwing here.
Or they like to throw the ball.
Pressure coming. Rawlings goes down. Edward Radinsky off the end, and that could effectively end this half. Yale will take a timeout as the clock is stopped with 14 seconds left. And in comes the side judge to signal that Yale timeout.
Princeton has just been successful. Look at this. The pressure they've been getting on Kurt Rawlings. And they're getting that pressure. Again, not enough to sack him, but just enough to disrupt his timing. They're getting that pressure with an undersized defensive line, without their stars that they had coming in to the beginning of the season on that defensive line. I think that to me, the two biggest surprises so far has been the performance of the defensive line for Princeton and the offensive line for Princeton.
Jack, you want a story of what shows these injuries and how it's affected this Princeton team. Edward Radzinski, who just had that sack there from a defensive end position, started the year at inside linebacker. With some injuries, he moved to outside linebacker. And with more injuries, he has moved to starting defensive end, his third position of the season.
It gives you a sense of some of the talent that they have on the bench here at Princeton. They can bring these guys in, even shift positions, and that they can become as effective as they've been.
Two proud teams claim a combined 55 national championships. Princeton claims 28. Yale claims 27. See if it's a handoff to Dudek here to end the half, or if Yale takes another shot. Throwing again. Comes underneath Dudek. In a one-on-one situation, is driven down short of the sticks with the clock winding. And Yale will take timeout once more. Boy, it tells you what Tony Reno thinks about how important points are here, that Yale's playing this out with 7 seconds to go in the half in their own end.
I think coming into this game, and you and I had some conversations with Tony Reno, he knew how talented this Princeton offense was, and more important, how dangerous this Princeton offense was. He had seen what they did to Harvard a couple of games ago. So it doesn't surprise me that what you're seeing here is the Yale offense saying, we're going to take advantage of every snap that we have here and see if we can turn something into points.
Reminder that coming up at halftime, we'll have highlights from last week in the Ivy League. We'll feature Mike Vitti and Dominique Rogers, two former college football players who served in the military, and we'll have first half highlights and analysis. That's all coming up at the half. Let's take another look out of town in the Ivy League. Penn still leads 20-6. Columbia still leads 3-0. So it's 20-6 Penn in the fourth quarter. 3-0 Columbia just before halftime in Ithaca. Everything as it was the last time we looked in. Likely the final play of this half. Rawlings scrambling, and he'll just get rid of it. So all that after the second timeout from Yale, and it sends us to halftime with Princeton ahead 24-14. An explosive third quarter, Jack, with 31 combined points in the second quarter.
the surprises we talked about, how well the Princeton offensive line has been able to protect Chad Kanoff and allowed him to continue on that torrid pace that he's had in terms of his completion percentage. And then the Princeton defensive line and what they've been able to do here. Now, we saw two possessions where Yale looked like what people thought Yale would be, with Zane Dudek and then putting other points on the board right before the half. So it's been a surprise, but exciting.
All right, Bob Sorace is down with Seth Kanter.
Coach, how do you evaluate the first 30 minutes?
We've done a lot of good things. We got to wrap up. The one time we don't tackle, they're an exceptional running back. He goes the distance, and we gave up the other big play. We got to execute a little better on offense. We made some big plays. Our play-to-play execution has got to raise another notch.
Best of luck.
Thank you.
All right, Seth, thank you very much. Well, this has been fun so far, as we expected it would be. That guy is both warm and stylish at halftime here at Princeton. Tigers 24. Bulldogs 14, plenty of fun ahead from New Jersey. We move to the second half, 24-14. Princeton leads Yale. Here's what's at stake again in this game. A Yale win means the Bulldogs would clinch at least a share of the Ivy Championship, and with a win in the rivalry game against Harvard next week, the game for Yale and Harvard fans, Yale would be the outright Ivy champion. Princeton can stay mathematically alive with two games remaining. That is, if they win this game and get some help. Right now, Cornell is losing to Columbia. Princeton needs Cornell to win that game to stay alive for the Ivy championship. Here are those bunched standings, and they'll look a whole lot more bunched if Yale can't come from behind here, Jack.
Yeah, and it goes back to what we talked about at the beginning of the telecast, and that is uncertainty often reigns in the Ivy League, especially when you get this late into the season. But this has been one of the seasons that's been a surprise, one of the most surprising ones in a long time. First of all, because the ones that were predicted to be up at the top, Princeton and Penn and Harvard, are not there anymore. Yale was predicted to be maybe fourth or fifth in the league, so they've exceeded their expectations. But the way Princeton is playing today, Bill, this looks like the Princeton team that had been projected to be atop the league.
Princeton deferred, so the Tigers received to start the second half. This is the dangerous Tiger, Besh, again. And he makes it only as far as the 20 before bouncing off contact and pushing ahead to the 27. Good return for Tiger Besh. Here comes the Princeton offense that put up ridiculous numbers again in the first half. 341 yards of offense in the first half for Princeton.
Coaches will often tell you that first series coming out of the locker room for the second half is essential. It sets the pace, it sets the tone and the stage certainly for the second half. What Princeton wants to do is continue what they've been doing offensively, moving the ball, generating points. Yale's defense needs to become Yale's defense because they have not been that so far today.
Yale leads the Ivy League in almost every defensive category but gave up 343 yards in the first half. Flag is out. On the first play of the second half, Steven Carlson goes just 5 yards. Princeton was not penalized in the first half. We will see from our referee, Michael Sechrist, if this is the first Tiger penalty of the game.
It was a block out on the outside that was able to spring him for that. The question is whether they're going to get a hold on the Princeton player or a hold on the Yale defensive player or whether they're going to pick up the flag.
There is no flag. Second down.
So Princeton still has not been penalized. That's a 5-yard gain. Second and 5 for the Tigers, looking to snap a 2-game losing streak. Those two losses came after 3 weeks where they look like the best team, not just in the Ivy League, but maybe in American football. They had scored 155 points in a 3-game win streak against Georgetown, Brown, and Harvard. Freshman Colin Eady fumbles the football. It's out on the turf, and Yale has it. Spencer Mathai jumps on the fumble. Just the spark the Bulldogs needed to start the second half.
We talked about how important that first possession is here, and Princeton was driving. Good gain on the first time. He had generated a good game, but once you, here's what Yale defense does and what good defenses do. Once they've got him, then arms start raking the ball. Look at this. Right there, he just didn't have that ball tucked in. That's one of the problems with having a freshman running back. It's a different level here, Division I football. But the question now is, can Yale take advantage of this wonderful field position at the Princeton 35?
Yale gained 284 yards in the first half, but only 14 points to show for it for the Bulldogs. Stalled out in this spot of the field a number of times after the fumble. Dudek fumbles right back, and Rawlings dives on it to save possession for Yale. Miscommunication on the zone read as Rawlings tried to pull it out at the end, and it led to a fumble.
I think you're right, Bill. It looked like he wanted to keep that ball. And Rawlings and Zane Dudek are talking about it right now. What he's going to do is he's going to read that, and he saw the defensive end crashing down on Zane Dudek, and I think wanted to pull that ball out, but it was a little bit too late. Yale lucky to get back on the ball.
It's a 6-yard loss, second and 16. Rawlings goes underneath for Christopher Williams-Lopez. It's a decent gain. Gained back all that lost yardage and two extra yards to set up third and 8. Christopher Williams-Lopez has 4 catches today. They've all been plays like that, running underneath the defense.
They love to drag him underneath. That ball is a little bit thrown behind him. If they get that ball out in his hand, he catches it in stride. Chances are he gets a little bit more out of it, but it's been an effective play for them all day long, dragging him over across the middle.
He broke out last year with a 169-yard day against Harvard in Yale's win against the Crimson, and that's the one game all year that means a little extra for the Bulldogs. Quickly out of the backfield to Dudek. Makes the first man miss, but gang tackling cuts Dudek down short. Really strong recovery from the linebacker Mike Perlowski, going deep down the depth chart with all these injuries for the Princeton defense.
Another ball that's just thrown a little bit behind Zane Dudek. He has to stop and come back to catch it rather than catch it on the run so he can utilize his speed to get around the edge. Yale deciding to go for it.
Stays on the field for fourth down. Yale 7 of 9 on fourth down this season. Just a 4-man rush. Down the seam, Ross Stroll's got it, touchdown! The Riverboat Gambler going for it on fourth down all the way to the end zone. Rawlings to Stroll!
Kurt Rawlings taking advantage. There was one high safety, and he got him moving to the left, to Yale's left, and he was able to come right down the seam. This is where a safety would ordinarily be. You saw he had a trailing defender who had him man-to-man. They'd ordinarily be looking for some safety help over the middle, but the safety had already moved to the right and is late getting back. Great read by Kurt Rawlings, great pattern run by Ross Strahl, and great delivery of the ball.
Ross Strahl's a senior. That's his first touchdown, and it pulls Yale within 3. The point after is good. 24-21 on 4th and 8. The Bulldogs find the end zone. We've got ourselves a game. 14 consecutive points for Yale. Bulldogs just score a touchdown on 4th and 8. A 38-yard touchdown pass from Kurt Rawlings to Ross Strahl with Jack Ford. I'm Bill Spaulding. And Jack, look what we've got now. This should be a great finish.
It's a game. You know, Yale has established a reputation of being a second-half team throughout the course of the season. Princeton helped them out by turning the ball over on their first series there. Again, coaches stress how you handle that first series after the halftime can be essential. And right now, Yale's happy with it.
Let's check in with the third member of our crew, Seth Canner. Seth.
class of 2014 here at Princeton and Karan. What are your fondest memories of playing football at Princeton University?
Man, I think my senior year, we clinched a championship here facing Yale. That was probably the biggest win because we beat them in a blowout.
What was it like going straight from the Ivy League into the NFL?
It was a lot of fun. I thought I was going to be able to make an immediate impact. That didn't happen, but I got to learn a lot my rookie year, ended up starting my second year, so it's been a really good process.
Having played with the Lions and the Chargers, what are you doing to try to get yourself back into the league?
Just staying in shape, staying mentally sharp, watching as much football as I can. It's a long process, but I'm ready.
Karan, thank you for your time.
I appreciate it. Thank you very much. Go Tigers.
All right, thank you very much, Seth. Karan Reed, one of a number of Ivy Leaguers every single year that gets a shot to play at the next level. Another returnable kick for Tiger Besh. Good seam. Besh makes a man miss. Had to try to beat one more to get to the outside. Instead, he's up to the 29. All of a sudden, it's Princeton up against it a bit. Tigers were up 24-7, allowed a late touchdown to the Bulldogs in the first half, and an early touchdown here in the second after a Princeton fumble. Here comes this offense that has been so steady all season long to try and weave them through these choppy waters.
They need to seize back some momentum here. Look, even if they don't get points out of this drive, they need to create a drive. Move the sticks a couple of times, get the offense back in their rhythm.
After Colin Eady fumbled, Charlie Volker's back in at running back. Pitch it to Graham Adamitis, forward on the shovel pass for 6 yards. That was an interesting take on a read option there.
An interesting play. You see that it looks like the first is a fake on the quick pitch that would get them around the end to Charlie Volker, and then ends up bringing the end around from the right side and does that little pop pass quick pitch coming up the middle. You don't often see your tight ends running that kind of play.
An injured player down on the field. Yale has been pretty healthy defensively this season. This is Hayden Carlson, the safety, wearing jersey number 26. Carlson has been a key part of this defense for his entire career. Tony Reno called him and his safety mate, Jason Alessi, the two rock stars of the secondary.
Good to see Hayden Carlson up. He's been a tackling machine during the course of, as you mentioned, his career. He's led the league a couple of times in tackles, been up at the top a number of times. Sometimes coaches will say they don't want their safeties being the leading tackler, but this is a situation where it wasn't as a result of a weakness in the front two levels of the defense. He's just a really good football player.
2 years ago, he led the Ivy League in tackles, was not named the first team All-Ivy, said his mom was livid with that decision. Underneath, wide open, Ryan Quigley has first down yardage coming out of the backfield for a gain of 6 yards. Don't get in the way of a mom and a trophy or an award for her son.
The last place you want to be.
Princeton offensively gained 341 yards in the first half. It's on pace for almost 700 yards of offense against a Yale team that only gives up about 290 yards a game. Quigley up the middle for three. In fact, with those past couple of games, Princeton is now over the 300-yard mark. That's a rare feat against this Yale team.
You're starting to get a feel the way the offenses have come alive on both of those teams, that this could be a last team with the ball wins type of game. Because right now, Yale has not been able to stop Princeton, and Princeton in the last few drives has not been able to stop Yale.
Say again?
Princeton played at an up-tempo pace in the second quarter, taking a bit of time here. Steven Carlson in motion. Still 10 on the play clock. Kanoff aimed tight. Carlson held up, but that was within 5 yards of the line of scrimmage. A clean play by Malcolm Dixon.
It was awfully close to a pick play that started off, and Carlson stopped and came back. I was looking as the play developed, thinking if he had turned up the sideline, there would have been nobody on him.
Sets up a third down. Princeton is 4 of 8 today on third down. Enter today first in FCS football at 53% on third down this season. It's the Yale fans making noise across the field. Kanoff with all day. That pops through the hands of Carlson. He was short of the first down marker anyway. Double coverage there between Malcolm Dixon and Foye Oluokun, a senior linebacker.
The continuing theme here, though, is Chad Kanoff has time to throw the ball. That's one, again, you're a little bit surprised that the receiver, Carlson, doesn't hang on to it. But Chad Kanoff has really not been pressured, Bill, at all by this defensive line. That's been the stalwart part of the Yale defense all season long.
He's thrown for 299 yards, but you could say he hasn't been all that sharp today. That's what we heard at the end of the half. Mejia knocked down as he punts, but no flag comes out. The ball's killed at the 32. Bob Cerace said at halftime, offense isn't executing all that well, just the big plays. And Yale holds him without a first down. Bulldog football within three.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
Back in Princeton, here's what's going on elsewhere in the Ivy League. It's gone final now in Boston. Penn beats Harvard 23-6. The Quakers have won three straight in the league. Both Penn and Harvard at 3-3 in league play. Cornell trails Columbia 6-0 at halftime. Columbia and Cornell both with two losses trying to stay in the race for the Ivy Championship. Yale scored touchdowns on its last two drives, 24-21. Princeton leads Yale, but the Bulldogs have the football. Don't tell her, though, that her team has lost some of the momentum.
There are
Princeton
a lot of
within three.
Folks in the stand wearing Tiger stripes. I guess it's fashionable now.
And it's also cold, so any extra layers you can get, even if it's that extra layer of fur, you'll take it. Yale football. Bulldogs, again, scored a long touchdown on the drive just before halftime and then scored on 4th-and-8 from the 38. A 38-yard pass from Kurt Rawlings to Ross Drawl last drive to make it a three-point game. Zane Dudek takes the carry on first down. Surging ahead, he twists for 8 yards. So Zane Dudek's over 100 yards today. 101 yards on 16 carries.
You know what I think he's showing today, Bill? He's not just a home run hitter, if we can mix our sports metaphors here. He's not just a guy who either takes it to the house or does nothing. He can get you 6 or 7 hard yards either between the tackles or breaking off around the edge.
And let's not forget, he did score a 47-yard touchdown as well. Rawlings keeps it himself, stumbling forward. Depends on the spot. And it looks like he has first down yardage. So with that final in Boston, let's take a look at the updated Ivy League standings. You see Penn has moved up to 3-3. Harvard has fallen behind that group of three teams with two losses. Yale still stands at the top. First down Bulldogs. Princeton late rushing a player onto the field. That's Charles Tomasetti sprinting in. Rawlings, quick hitter wide, almost caught on the bobble by Fury as J.P. Shofi was hammered. Great coverage on the outside safety, T.J. Floyd all over J.P. Shofi.
Well, a little high. We've mentioned that Kurt Rawlings has been a little bit off on some of his throws, but that was just a great defensive play to come in and undercut Shofi, the receiver, to keep him from making that completion.
Rawlings, 17 of 26 today. He's thrown for 227 yards and 2 touchdowns. Once down 24-7, Yale within three, looking to clinch at least a share of the Ivy Championship. Here's Williams Lopez on the screen, only gains 2. Open field tackle from a blocked cornerback, Delance Stallworth, a freshman, going low to topple down the big wide receiver.
Stallworth played that perfectly. For that play to work, you got 2 receivers and 2 defenders. So for that play to work, 1 receiver has to get a good block on the 1 defender, and then the receiver has to make 1 guy miss. But before they even got there, the defender was able to fight through the block and make the tackle. So an excellent play by the defensive back.
It's another big third down coming. It's a part of the field where Yale has stalled out on about half its drives. Just a 4-man rush. Out of the backfield, Dudek has the first down. Rawlings finds him for a gain of 9 on Zane Dudek's 5th catch today.
We talked about how Zane Dudek can help you in so many ways. Good coverage, Jackson Simcox, number 41 there. It's a family tradition for Simcox. His dad, Steve, played for Princeton a number of years ago. But you saw right there that Dudek can take the ball out of the backfield and just stretch the play to get that first down.
Now Melvin Rouse spells Dudek in the backfield. Ball goes to Rouse on the sweep. Rouse finds a seam. He's another freshman converted wide receiver. Played wide out the first six games this year before Deshaun Salter's injury, and he scampers ahead for 18 yards.
You realize that they've taken him, a guy who started as a wide receiver. You can see he got some speed, finds the seam, great block by the defensive line, finds the seam, turns on the jets. It was a guy who had been moved. He was a high school running back, came in as a freshman, and was gaining good time as a wide receiver. But as their backs went down, they figured we got to reconvert him to running back, and he's been a good option, spelling Zane Dudek.
Dudek's back in with the ball, bounces outside. Dudek runs through the cornerback Melanson, and the safety Ben Ellis drives him out after a 5-yard gain.
What a great play by Melanson, because we know what kind of speed Zane Dudek has, and it looked like he had the edge, but Melanson played it perfectly. Dudek got his arm out for a straight arm, but Melanson stayed with him, got him out of bounds.
Training staff checking in on our umpire. He got caught in the mess of bodies blocking about 5 yards out past the line of scrimmage. So they'll keep a close eye on that referee.
Hopefully he's okay. You know, it's almost a surprise that it doesn't happen more often. I mean, these guys are, these officials are so good. They're in the middle of the play. They're being where they want to be. But you have so much going on. If you can take a look at this up in the top left corner of the screen, there's so much going on there. You can see right now, right there, he's about to get hit. And it was just a Princeton guy being pushed away from the flow, stumbling into the official.
All right, we'll step aside as they tend to our umpire with Princeton up 3. So Tony Reno's squad will resume the drive. Yale can clinch its first Ivy title in 11 years with a win today. It would guarantee them a share of the Ivy League, and they don't use tiebreakers. So if you get a share of the title, you're considered an Ivy League champion. Yale would also have a chance then next week to beat Harvard and be the outright Ivy champion. Yale driving, they've scored 14 consecutive points here in Princeton in front of one of the best crowds of the year at Powers Field at Princeton Stadium.
Not just, not just a good Princeton crowd, but a good Yale crowd,
yep,
too.
Dudek lowers the shoulder, pushes to the sticks. Stopped a half a yard short of a first down, third and less than one.
You get a sense now that the Yale offensive line is starting to dig in and starting to dominate. Again, we've talked about how injury-prone the Princeton defensive line has been, how many guys they've gone through, starters who are gone for the season, how many, some of these guys were actually scout team players. First down for Yale.
Yeah, the spot measured for a first down. Yep.
But you get a sense, Bill, that all of a sudden that the offensive line is starting to assert itself here for Yale.
So first down, Yale. Ball spotted at the 15. Tight end Jaden Graham rotates in. He caught a touchdown pass back in the first half. This is Dudek. He's over 1,000 yards on the season and gains 2. Those 2 yards give him 1,001 in his freshman season, the first Ivy running back since 2014 to get over the 1,000-yard mark.
And you remember, he's done it now in 8.5 games where he wasn't even starting until just, what, 2 games or so ago. So it just gives you a sense of how good this young man is, and boy, what he might do down the road. I was talking to my son, who played lacrosse at Yale. One of his best friends was the legendary Yale running back, Mike McLeod, who owns just about all of the Yale rushing records. And I said, you know what, give Mike a call. He might want to watch this guy.
Princeton trying to hold Yale to at most a field goal here. Rawlings underneath. Christopher Williams-Lopez undercut, a yard shy of the sticks. It's a good tackle coming up from Thomas Johnson, the junior linebacker, who has been outstanding this season, averaging close to 10 tackles a game.
Yale's been able to do now is they're asserting the running game. It's drawing those linebackers in. All of a sudden, they're taking one step either in or to the side, respecting the running game, and it's opening up the middle of that area, that short passing zone for the Yale receivers. Christopher Williams-Lopez has made a living out of that area for his 4 years at Yale.
It's third and less than a yard. Dudek up the middle, dragging tacklers inside the one. First and goal, knocking on the goal line.
This is what offensive linemen love. They just say, just give those guys the ball and let us clear the path. And right now, that's what the Yale offensive line is doing.
Here goes Dudek again. Hit, falling forward. And he's down short of the goal line.
Yale claiming that he spun into the end zone. But the officials are having none of it. But you can't get much closer to that goal line than where that ball is right now.
Dudek's a confident freshman. He just looked over the sideline, gave the signal as if, hey, give it to me again. Let's do it.
Exactly. You can see how close that ball is right there. This is one you can see. You can see Kurt Rawlings putting his stomach and just taking it out and almost walking into the end zone as everybody crashes down on Zane Dudek.
Siragusa in motion. It goes to Dudek. This time he's in. Touchdown, Yale. For the first time today, the Bulldogs lead. 20 straight points. The extra point will make it 21 in a row and put Yale up four if Alex Gallant can knock it through.
You can see just straight big boy football. Yale offensive lineman just pushing forward, nothing fancy, and Zane Dudek just following his blockers.
Second touchdown today, 13th this year for Dudek. Gallant's point after is right down the middle. 28-24. Yale, who looked really on shaky ground with about a minute left before halftime, has stormed back in front. That touchdown just before halftime was the spark that has driven them since.
Funny, you mentioned it. It's what we saw early in the season with Yale and Cornell. Yale was inept for most of that first half. They scored right before the second half, and all of a sudden you could see the momentum shift. They came out and basically took Cornell apart in the second half. Now, if you're Bob Cerace, you've got to gather your guys around and say, you know what, we're still only down 4 points here. And we've been really effective with that ball. So let's not, even though it feels a little bit like the air has been let out of the balloon on the Princeton side of the stadium here where we are, he has to convince his guys, this game isn't over yet. We've been able to put points on these guys, and there's no reason why we can't continue to do it. So this possession, even though it's you know, there's still an entire quarter and about 4 minutes left to go, this is an extremely important possession for the Princeton offense.
11 Sports will bring you coverage of Ivy League basketball and hockey all season long. Tune in with us weekly to watch live coverage of men's basketball and men's hockey from the prestigious schools in the Ivy League. 28-24, Yale leads Princeton 21 in a row for the Bulldogs, who can clinch a share of the Ivy Championship with a win. Once more, it's Tiger Besh. And he's contained out to the 23, an 18-yard return. Jack, here comes Princeton's offense again, and though they've scored 24 points, it's really been thanks to the big play, an 88-yard touchdown. He had the 58-yard touchdown, and then a 33-yard touchdown as well. So they haven't strung long drives together as much as they have hit the home runs.
Yeah, they've been able to be the sort of lightning in a bottle offense here. And what they need, as you said, Bill, what they need to do is string together a really strong drive here to get them back into this.
Charlie Volker into the pile, and look at him push bodies ahead for 5 yards. He's a guy who could get Princeton going. Volker has been held to only 27 yards on eight carries.
And he has that ability. You get him through that first line and get him into the back level of the defense. We've talked about his speed, his elusiveness. He has the ability to turn a game around.
Chad Knopf's thrown for 299 yards.
With a quarter left to play.
A lot of that to Jesper Horsted, who's pulled in 116 receiving yards and a touchdown. Sweet play, Volker. Boy, that hole closed very quickly. He gains just 3 yards. Jason Alessi and Ryan Burke converged on him.
You're right, Bill. I thought there was going to be much more there for him, but it was good flow by the second level, the linebacker level of the Yale defense.
So here's another third down. Princeton's been so good on third down this year. It's 53%. Today, though, only 4 for 9.
Almost won. Just get in the next play.
Knopf taking a shot down the middle. Tiger Besh is wide open. Now it's a foot race. Besh down the seam and inside the 15. 57 yards to Tiger Besh.
That was such a cleverly designed play because you're looking at saying, how did Tiger Besh get so wide open? Well, the reason he got so wide open is Princeton looked like they were going to do that bubble screen they did. Watch this. He's looking out to the left, and Tiger Besh sets up like he's going to block and then releases downfield. And the fake wasn't a big fake, but it was enough of a fake out to the outside that sprung Tiger Besh free. So just a well-designed play by the Princeton offense.
He's over 100 yards receiving today, 143 yards for Besh. On play action, Knopf rolling, throws over the middle, and it's incomplete. Malcolm Dixon on the dive, broke it up in front of Steven Carlson. Dixon, a sophomore, moved from safety to cornerback with some injuries to that Yale secondary in the midway point of the season.
Great coverage there. Ball a little bit low. Chad Knopf was forced out of the pocket, had to move to his right. A little bit low, but a great play by Dixon.
Chad Knopf's thrown for almost 400 yards. By the way, his next touchdown would pass Doug Butler as the single-season Princeton record holder. He finds Horsted on the slant, and he has the Princeton record! Jesper Horsted has the single-season receiving record. Chad Knopf has the single-season touchdown record. And boy, that's just so fitting that the two reach that mark together.
That's what these guys have been doing throughout their careers here. Chad Knopf has time, runs that Jesper Horsted runs that quick slant we talked about before. Chad Knopf puts the ball up high where his 6'4" receiver can go get it, and we have two record setters.
So Jesper Horsted sets the record with 12 touchdown catches. Princeton record 26 touchdown pass for Chad Knopf. Tigers are back on top, and with Tavish Rice's point after, Princeton leads by a field goal.
To take a look at this, once again, you can see Horsted is the middle man in the triple setup on the left side. You have the inside guy run inside to draw the linebacker with him. Horsted just makes a quick move to the inside. He gets the defender on his outside hip. And the receiver then, once he's in that position, and once Chad Knopf realizes that, puts the ball exactly where his 6'4" guy can go get it.
Six catches, 128 yards, and two touchdowns for Jesper Horsted. Chad Knopf is thrown for four touchdowns today, and there's the response the Tigers needed after Yale had scored 21 in a row. Princeton's back on top.
When you look at what Chad Knopf is doing, you know, we talked about this rivalry. It takes me back 1981, one of the great upsets by Princeton. An undefeated, nationally ranked Yale team comes into, it was then Palmer Stadium. Bob Holley was the Princeton quarterback, threw for 501 yards against Yale in a 34-31 win. Yale's Rich Diana, first team running back, All-American, ran for 220 yards. So we're seeing some similarities here. The great Yale running back, the great Princeton quarterback. By the way, both Rich Diana and Bob Holley had good NFL careers afterwards.
A lot of the captains from Princeton football teams were here in attendance today as well. They were honoring all the captains in Princeton football history. This is kicked all the way through for a touchback, and it gives us time to remind you that this game is live on Twitter. You can check it out at 11 Sports USA. This game right now and other Ivy League games throughout the season live on Twitter on 11 Sports for the fans. Jack, let's go back to the Princeton legacy. More than 40 captains all time at Princeton here today.
Isn't that astonishing? In almost 150 years of Princeton football, there are apparently 84 still living captains. And as you said, they got more than 40 of them to show up today. And I must say that one of my cousins, Steve Reynolds, who's the captain of the 79 team, was happy to be here. I told him I'd meet up with him after the game. And he says, well, it depends on what the final score is.
And that's still in suspense. 31-28, Princeton leads Yale. A game that's seesawed here in the third quarter. Zane Dudek shakes a tackle and churns forward. This is patented Zane Dudek now, 8 yards there. For the first quarter and a half, Princeton did a really good job tackling him. Now he's starting to be slippery.
I think you're seeing a couple of things. Again, I think you're starting to see the Yale offensive line dominate. Most important, I think you're starting to see that at least the first two levels of the Princeton defense get worn out. They've been on the field a lot.
Rawlings slings it out. Christopher Williams Lopez off the juggle is hammered. Made the catch, but DeLand Stallworth stops him shy of the 30 to set up third down.
That play was just a little awkward, and for that one to work, we talked about it before. You got two wide receivers out there, two defenders. It has to be a quick throw out to one wide receiver. He's got to get the block from his partner out there, and so he has the ability to make the next guy miss. But when a play is that slow developing and he has to stop and come back for the ball, it's just not going to go anywhere.
Third and short for Yale, down three. Dudek hit at the line, churns the legs, and gains first down yardage on the second effort. Now, Zane Dudek having to carry the workman-like load today. That's his 20th carry, second most carries in his freshman season, and it moves the chains.
And you look at him, he's not a big guy. I mean, he's solid, but he's not a big guy, and he's moving piles constantly here, again showing that he's more than just a speed guy with a lot of twitch to him.
Rushed for 4,000 yards in his high school senior season, including 492 yards in one game.
That's just astonishing. It's almost incomprehensible.
Rawlings takes a shot, has Ross Drawl again, and finds him. It's the best game of the year for Ross Drawl, a long touchdown reception earlier, and this catch moves about 27 yards downfield to end quarter number three.
Ross Drawl is a little outside move. You can see the little shoulder fake by Kurt Rawlings. That was just enough to draw the safety up and also draw the man who's covering Ross Drawl up. He turns it back up the field, a great completion.
Well, we had high expectations for this game, and they have lived up to the expectations. Just a three-point lead for Princeton heading to the fourth. Well, it's the second most played rivalry in college football. There was a lot on the line coming into this 140th meeting between Yale and Princeton. Bulldogs looking to clinch a share of the Ivy title. Princeton trying to bounce back from two straight losses and stay alive in the race. This game was hyped coming in, and Jack Ford, so far this game has lived up to the hype. 31-28 Princeton in a game that is seesawed back and forth, and it may seesaw again here. Yale has the football in Princeton territory after Ross Drawl, who you just saw on the training table, pulling a 36-yard pass before the end of the third quarter.
I don't think there's anybody in this really good crowd here today at Princeton Stadium who has decided to leave this game yet, Bill.
I mean, the traffic's going to be a nightmare getting out of here, but it'd be worth it for these fans who came early. It was 25 degrees this morning. We got here about 3 hours before kickoff, and the tailgate lots were already full. This is Dudek, his 21st carry. He's rushed for more than 120 yards and picks up three here. Now, forced to be the every down back, it does take away a little bit of his home run threat because he's not coming in for a carry or two to burst out and then go back to the bench with Deshaun Salter, yet still having a very productive day.
He is, and I think that's a good point, because when Deshaun Salter was banging up in between the tackles, you had everybody crowding down into the box, and then all of a sudden Zane Dudek would step on the field, and they turned on the jets and go around the edge. But it's interesting to see what Princeton has been able to do to
low
hold
snap
him so far.
Rawlings digs it out, makes something out of nothing on a broken play. He's inside the 30, gaining 6 yards to set up third and manageable.
He got hammered on that tackle. He's a little slow getting up. You can see the athleticism of Kurt Rawlings now. The ball, it was a low snap. He's able to corral it, sees nothing going on, finds something here, but you're going to see him get literally hammered. Watch this. Boom.
That's Trevor Forbes, the safety, that's, a hard,
you
know, hitter.
That's actually an interesting play. That could be a penalty because he delivered a hit to the head. Even though it wasn't shoulder hit, it was still a hammer hit to the head. And if you talk about the rules, and the officials have been watching them carefully, that probably should have been a flag.
Third and three for Yale. This would be a career-long field goal for Alex Gallant if they don't convert. Screen pass, Williams Lopez. He converts. 7-yard gain. That was really well blocked by J.P. Shofi.
Let's take a look at the previous play here. You can see, bang.
Yeah, right across the face mask.
Right. And it's, again, it's look, a lot of times you might have incidental contact, but officials have been told even if it's incidental, if it's to the head, it's supposed to be called. And that was, again, it wasn't intending to try to harm him, but you had a hammer blow coming that hit him right smack in the side of the helmet. I think that's pretty much the definition of an illegal hit to the head.
Here's Dudek. Cuts back. What a move by Dudek inside the 10, dragging tacklers down to the 3. His jersey nearly came off as Quincy Wolf was trying to hang on, but Dudek kept going.
Where does all the power come from? Well, you know what? He just has that balance. So it's not raw power. It's just balance and that ability to drive his legs. Look at that. Finds the seam. 1, 2, still going. 3, 4, 5, 6 guys. Now, if you're Yale, you're always worried about somebody getting hurt in that last part of a play where you're moving the pile. But Zane Dudek, again, turns this into a big-time first down. For
first and goal, Yale. Dudek pushes forward. Touchdown, Bulldogs. His third today.
It's, for some reason, nobody can get a clean shot on it. You and I have seen him now a couple of games this year, and we both marveled at the ability for him to slip tackles. Look at this. 1, 2. Once again, got him. 3. It's just that the first guy almost never brings him down.
27 carries, 154 yards, and 3 touchdowns for Zane Dudek. Yale's back on top by a field goal as they tend to an injured Princeton player down by the goal line. What a day by Dudek, who's a ferocious competitor. We were told he fumbled the football for the only time in his career against Columbia as they were trying to salt the game away. Went over to the sideline, said to Coach Tony Reno, give me the ball again. That is never going to happen again. And here he is. He hasn't fumbled since.
You can see this. They put notches, marks on his cheek. One of the people on the sidelines come over, and apparently they've done it for each touchdown. So he's got tiger stripes,
yep,
is my guess. Being a former Yale football player, and you want to try and rub it in on Princeton,
yep,
guys, my guess is those are tiger stripes, one for each one of his 3 touchdowns.
3-point lead. Everyone will come back in for the extra point here for Alex Gallant, who's made every extra point he's taken today. Now, you have the feeling that is not the last touchdown we'll see the way these two offenses are playing. Alex Gallant's extra point puts Yale back ahead by 4. Now, Zane Dudek, just a freshman, but he's already a shining star in the Ivy League. Bulldogs lead by 4.
You can make it if you try.
After Zane Dudek's touchdown, 35-31. First place Yale leads Princeton. They've scored 28 of the last 35 points, all sparked by the long touchdown pass, a 58-yarder from Kurt Rawlings to his tight end, Jaden Graham, just before halftime.
Starting to like my prediction from earlier that the last team with the ball is going to win this game, because clearly Princeton has not given up. I think they have performed so much better against this Yale defense than anybody expected they would, perhaps except Princeton. So they haven't been willing to roll over, and they punched back every time Yale has scored on them. So we're into the fourth quarter now, about 12 minutes, 14 seconds left. This possession, let's see if Princeton is able to move the sticks and come up with some points.
906 combined yards of offense right now. Yale's gained 467 yards. Princeton has gained 439. And it's against the defense that's ranked top five nationally in total defense, rush defense, and scoring defense. Alex Gallen kicks it away. Playing with fire here. This is the fifth return for the dangerous Tiger Besh. And Besh is all the way out past the 30. Surprising they haven't just tried to kick it through the end zone against the dangerous Besh.
Yeah, but I like Tiger Besh. I mean, he just is a tough kid. You mentioned before there's a flag down. Have to see what this is. Usually you'd be talking about some kind of hold on the return.
If it's a penalty on Princeton, it's the first penalty on the Tigers today, and it comes in the fourth quarter. Princeton is the least penalized team in the Ivy League.
We'll go back to Tiger Besh again. We talked about before, he's just not big, but he's got great heart. He's a tough kid, and he's got some speed on top of that. So, as you said, Bill, every time he touches the ball, I think the Yale sides better be holding their breath.
During a return, personal foul, smack, receiving team number 45. 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down, Princeton.
You don't see that all that often. That is Mitchell Dene, a fullback who's on the return team, called for the face mask while he was out blocking. So that backs up Princeton 15 yards off the return.
You know, you'll see that sometimes, but it's usually called hand to the face on the offensive line, where they're hand fighting, offensive linemen are hand fighting with defensive linemen, and the hand gets up there in the face mask area. I can't remember having seen a face mask called on the receiving team on a kick return.
So here's Princeton's offense once more. Went down the field and scored a touchdown last drive. Jesper Horsted pulled in his second touchdown catch of the game. Chad Kanoff is thrown for 369 yards. He's throwing on first down. Hit as he throws, and Carlson can't come up with it. Just out in front of him. And that's the first time all day Kanoff has been knocked down against a Yale team that averages four sacks a game.
They put a big hit on him. You can see here, coming in free. Nobody picks him up. But he still is able to deliver a catchable ball, which gives you a sense of how big and strong and how accurate Chad Kanoff is.
This is pitched to the outside. Charlie Volker, the Ivy League sprint champion, uses his speed to move the sticks.
You know, it's the new era version of a sweep. You know, people will remember, older folks will remember the Southern Cal student body right, student body left. Basically, you get a running back out there, get him already in motion, and make a quick pitch to him, and it gets him to the edge.
16 yards for Volker, the longest run today for Princeton. Looking for Carlson again. He's got it this time behind Dixon and into plus territory. Gain of 32. Kanoff's over 400 yards passing today.
Carlson comes back and makes an exceptional catch here. Dixon has his back to the ball. All he really needs to do is turn his head, and he could have made a play on that ball. You can see right there, never turns, never reads the ball. You know, you tell the backs, when you see a receiver turn and he looks up, you've got to turn your head and look up also.
Boy, this is a heavyweight slugfest. Two great teams countering with haymaker after haymaker. Play action underneath. Graham Adamitis, the tight end, is taken down in open field. That is an outstanding tackle by one of the best tacklers in the league, safety Hayden Carlson. Still a five-yard gain.
By Hayden Carlson, because he had a lot of room to run. He had a defensive end, looked like he was going to go out with the tight end on that screen, but then let him run.
Volker hits an immediate tackler. Ryan Burke got him first, and he was brought down the rest of the way by Carlson. By the way, we haven't seen Colin Eady, the talented freshman running back for Princeton, since he fumbled on the opening play of the second half.
Tough when you lose your coach's confidence by putting the ball on the ground like that to get back on the field.
Big play third and two or three right here raised the question whether they'd look at this as four down territory.
Kanoff taking a shot for Horsted. Coming back to the ball. He pulled it in. Jesper Horsted from his backside somehow brings it in for a first down. And now they'll say incomplete. Wow.
Interesting. Shades of what happened to Princeton last week with an official from across the field coming in and ruling their touchdown against Penn. No good. Look at this. You can see Horsted does an out and up.
Now that bounced.
I think that's
a good call.
That is a good call. You can see the official right in the middle of the screen right now, and he actually, even though he was far away, he had the best view of whether the ball bounced or not.
So it was originally called a catch by the line judge, but the back judge makes a tremendous call. That bounced on his right hip. Fourth and two.
Good job. Good job by the officiating crew here.
And Princeton will take timeout. Well, Bob Cerace is hot now, but when he goes back and sees it on tape, he'll realize that was the correct call. Princeton will talk things over before a huge fourth down play. That's next. That's a frustrated Bob Cerace, not just over the incomplete complete call, which we think is the right call, but throughout the break, he was talking to the referees. He thought Jesper Horsted was held there.
And he was yelling at the official. That was two times in a row that he claimed his receiver was held. And if you remember, the receiver, Jesper Horsted, did an out and up. And if you're going to be held, you know, I'm a former defensive back, and we've all been in situations where the guy's beating us on the up part of it, and what you do is you reach out and just grab the jersey, figuring, all right, if I can stop the touchdown, I'll take my penalty. And Bob Cerace says that was two times, according to him, that his receiver was held and no flags were thrown.
And sets up a big fourth down. Would have been a 48-yard field goal. That's out of the range of Tavish Rice, whose season long is 40. So the offense on the field, fourth and three for Princeton, trailing Yale by 4 points. Jesper Horsted has been one of the big targets this week. 128 yards receiving and two touchdowns. He's alone on Spencer Rimashevsky.
Chad Kanoff making change of the call line at the line of scrimmage as they line up.
Pressure coming. Kanoff throws. Broke it up. Hayden Carlson bangs it down on fourth down, and Yale's defense holds.
Hayden Carlson played that perfectly from the beginning. He was reading Chad Kanoff's eyes, and Chad Kanoff, as experienced as he is and as good as he is, I suspect he'll look back on that and he'll say, if I had looked the safety off, you can see right there, he never took his eyes away from Jesper Horsted. Well, what a surprise. If I'm looking for a guy to go to, it's going to be him. But the reality is the Yale defense knows that also. So he never looked the safety off. And a great play by Hayden Carlson to break up that pass.
And if that wasn't fourth down, it's a pick. Carlson threw it to the turf intentionally on fourth down. Senior play from him. So Yale takes over. Bulldogs have scored 28 of the last 35. Movement. This will be our first false start penalty in a very clean game 5 minutes into the fourth quarter.
It really has been. Gives you a sense of how disciplined these two teams are. And that always flows from the top and your coaching staff.
Offense, number 63, 5-yard penalty, first down.
That's right guard Anders Huizinga. And while we have a chance, boy, this Yale offensive line's about as impressive as it gets. Anders Huizinga planning to go to law school after working in a medical office last year. John Benesi, the right tackle who's injured, has interned with the Yale Bindra Laboratory. And the left tackle, Carl Marbach, is on the Yale undergraduate aerospace engineering team that launched a rocket into outer space last year.
You know when people say, well, you know, it's not rocket science?
Yeah.
He is truly a rocket scientist.
He could tell you whether or not it's actually rocket
and
science.
And actually, he and Chad Kanoff, two are the semifinalists for the Campbell Trophy, which is often referred to as the Academic Heisman Trophy, to give you a sense of how talented those two men, young men, are academically.
Just a 2-yard gain for Dudek, who has set his career high with 28 carries today. Here's his 29th with some space, cuts it back. And it closes down. Thomas Johnson caught him in a one-on-one situation. Third and long coming for Yale. Three and out would be huge here for Princeton's defense.
Remember, there were 10 minutes left when they went for that on fourth down. So that wasn't as dramatic as the decision as you might have thought. But that last play was exceptional job of flowing to the ball because it looked like Dudek had a lane to run.
Yale is 7 for 15 on third down. Need the 41 for a first down. Rawlings with all day. First down. Michael Saragossa over the middle pulls in his first catch of the day.
Michael Saragossa had broke onto the scene as a freshman. You can see this once again. Kurt Rawlings, look at all the time he has. Look at all the time to deliver that ball. Michael Saragossa broke onto the scene as a freshman, had a great game against Harvard as a freshman, and been banged up for the last couple years. So the Yale people have been happy to see him reemerge this year as an important part of their receiving corps.
Kurt Rawlings is having a great game. 75% completion rate. He's thrown for 298 yards. Now it's Dudek tunneling forward for six more yards. Three touchdowns for Zane Dudek. 168 yards down the ground and no negative plays. He has not lost a yard yet today.
That's astonishing because we've talked about this before. He's not a big pounding running back, even though he finishes runs strongly. But at his size, and especially every snap you're taking in a shotgun situation, so you're starting 5 yards behind the line of scrimmage for every play. You know, odds are somebody's going to catch you behind the line of scrimmage, but it hasn't happened at all today.
Sling it out to Christopher Williams. Lopez makes one man miss, and he steps out very close to the first down marker. He'll be just shy at the 45. Third and short coming. Blocking kind of broke down on that screen pass. He had to step out of the first tackle.
Yale hasn't had that much success today with that play. They use it regularly. It's been very successful for them during the course of the season. But Princeton has played it very well. That first defender who fights through the block just blows up that pattern, and they've been successful doing it all day long today.
Another chance for Princeton's defense to get off the field. Blitz coming. Dudek spins forward. The second effort enough for a first down. He'd been stopped short on first contact.
And what you're seeing now, again, Yale wants to take over. You know, if this was back in the days when they did huddles, they'd be in a huddle and Kurt Rawlings would be looking at his offensive lineman and saying, all right, guys, it's on you right now. Want to walk off this field with a win and a share of the Ivy title? We're putting it all on you. You take over this line of scrimmage and we're going to run this clock out.
Reminder, coming up next on 11 Sports, we'll go to Fenway Park for UMass and Maine. Right now it's Yale trying to clinch at least a share of the Ivy League championship, leading by 5 at Princeton. Second carry today for Melvin Rouse, and he almost broke it again. Rush for 21 yards on his first carry of the day. He gains 6 here on first down. Yale keeping it on the ground. They've already eaten up 4 minutes on this drive.
See, Rouse is pumped up. He jumped up, high-stepping after that. He was a stride or two away from busting that one right up the middle, as a matter of fact. Yale already having run about a good solid 4 minutes off the clock since they stopped Harvard on that 4th-and-3 possession.
Yale's converted twice on third down already this drive. Dudek, good hole off the right side. Down to about the 33, and it depends on the spot. Mark it down. Half a yard shy of the first down marker. Here's a third down of this drive. Can Princeton finally penetrate as the Tigers have an injured player down on the field?
Yeah, we talked before about the fact that Zane Dudek had not carried the ball for 20 carries at all this season. Now he's way above that. And the question was, well, how is he going to hold up with that? Well, if you go back to his high school career, he carried the ball a lot then, but it's a lot different now when you're up in Division I.
As I check on the injured player, we take a break. Close game. Big play coming from Princeton.
This experience. It lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
More football ahead on 11 Sports Today. Immediately following this game, we go to Fenway Park for UMass and Maine in the Gridiron Series. Then we finish our day in the Big Sky Conference, Montana State and Northern Arizona. Got plenty of meat on the bone here still in Princeton, New Jersey. 5:33 to go, fourth quarter. Yale leading by four, looking to salt this game away and lock up at least a share of the Ivy Championship for the first time in 11 years. With Jack Ford, I'm Bill Spaulding. It's third and less than a yard. Zane Dudek has carried it 30 times. He's the tailback. His 31st carry, first down and way more. Needed less than a yard, he gained five.
I had to believe that where Yale was at the time, that was clearly four down territory. They had to believe that Zane Dudek in two carries was going to get them 1 yard. He gets it in one carry. Now, at some point in time, Princeton has to get concerned about the clock, because right now Yale's playing Princeton and the clock here. They've run more than 6 minutes off of the clock since they took over in that last possession when they held Princeton on a fourth down.
Dudek's gained 179 yards. Remember, Princeton only has two timeouts because they used a timeout before the fourth down play earlier this quarter. Dudek again breaks the first tackle, and look at all the black jerseys coming to meet him. John Orr, the first hit. Thomas Johnson and friends cleaned him up.
I can't tell you how impressive this Princeton defense has been. Now, you might look and say, well, wait a minute. They allowed 35 points. You're right. But this is a powerful, talented Yale offense, and it's been a decimated Princeton defense.
Yep.
And these guys have shown enormous heart out here on the field. These guys, as we mentioned before, guys at the beginning of the season, half of them weren't even setting foot on that field, and they showed up for this game.
Remember, though, Princeton led this game 24-7 late in the second quarter. Yale scored just before halftime, and they have outscored Princeton 28-7. Dudek taken down immediately. No gain for Zane Dudek. You say that so rarely for a guy who averages 9 yards a carry. Thomas Johnson got in there quickly, as did Edward Radinsky.
Now, at this point, Princeton is just selling out on the run. On that last play, you had looked like eight guys in the box. You had two guys playing man, press man on the outside, and one high safety. And put Yale in a position where now they're saying, I don't think that we can just run out the rest of this quarter here.
Here's the third down stop Princeton needs. 3:20 and counting to go. Third and eight. Yale needs the Princeton 20 for a first down. Just a four-man rush. Rawlings fires short of the first down. Christopher Williams-Lopez brings it in. Fourth down and four. An interesting decision here for Tony Reno on what would be a 41-yard field goal. Here comes the kicking team. Alex Gallen comes out, the junior. This would be his season long. Longest this year is 39 yards. Would make it a 6-point game, but keep Princeton alive. This is no good. Princeton within three.
Now, it's interesting. Princeton put no pressure on the kicker. They did not want to. They figured, all right, we're not going to block this, but we don't want to put ourselves in a situation where a penalty could give Yale a first down. So on the snap, the Princeton defense just basically stood up. And you're wondering how disconcerting that might have been for a kicker.
So Princeton within 4 points. Curious your thoughts there. Obviously, a field goal would have made it a 7-point game, a full touchdown advantage for the Bulldogs.
Yeah. See what we're talking about? They basically just stood up. That's an interesting call.
Yep.
I'm not so sure. Look, it's easy for us up here to say, all right, let's go for it on fourth down. They're still going to have to score a touchdown. You know, if they convert it, then it's a 7 points. So the touchdown, the extra point doesn't beat them. Probably the odds, if you're playing the odds, it says kick the field goal.
Except if it doesn't go in.
Princeton takes over, down four. 2:20 to play. It's another late game nail biter for Tigers fans. Lost the last two games by less than a field goal. Knauf has a wide open Tiger. Besh, he's got it with a flag out. Besh into Yale territory will wait for the flag that came out in the defensive secondary. If it stands, it's a 29-yard gain.
It's against Yale, so you have to believe Princeton is going to turn it down. Tiger Besh has been the guy to show up today.
Pass interference, defense, number 19.
That's Jason Alessi. Princeton declines it. Tiger Besh has gained 174 yards on five catches. Chad Knauf is thrown for 453. Tigers in business in Yale territory. First down, 2:12 and counting to go.
Best part of that play was Chad Knauf corralling that high, wide snap.
Again, pocket holds. Knauf underneath. It bounces out of Besh's breadbasket.
Just when we compliment him on the game he's played so far, you can see how upset he is. He's looking to turn and run before you get that ball in. And, you know, receivers are told, yeah, get your hands out. If the ball gets into your pads, we're going to see exactly what happened there. It just bounces off of his chest.
A lot of folks in the Ivy League watching right now and rooting pretty hard for the Tigers. A Princeton win would keep about five teams in the race for an Ivy championship. Knauf underneath, right back to Besh. And he can't go anywhere, couldn't make Spencer Rimashevsky, the Yale captain, miss. It's just a two-yard gain, 3rd and 8 coming. Yale's defense trying to lock down an Ivy championship.
Great coverage by Spencer Rimashevsky. Lets him catch the two-yard pass, but most important, he makes the tackle and puts him on the ground.
Another big
clearly
third down.
Clearly four-down territory here with less than 2 minutes left on the clock.
Cut off, taking off on a quarterback draw. Yale was ready for it. Foye Oluokun stops him for no gain. Timeout Princeton, and the game will come down to this 4th and 9 play.
You know what? You've got some great scouting on that because Princeton will use that quarterback draw. Not often, but in the past, they've used it on big downs like this. And you saw Foye Oluokun, and essentially he was shadowing Chad Knauf. They knew, and I'm sure the coaches said to him, when they get in this situation, they like to run that quarterback draw. We talked about Chad Knauf. He can run. Chad Knauf, he can run. But just a great coverage by Oluokun. And now, going back to what we said before, team of the ball last wins. 4th and 9 here for Princeton.
Princeton today, 0-for-1 on fourth down. If Yale holds on to win this game, one of the keys will be that Princeton on third down today is just 5-for-12. And Jack, this season, Princeton has been so good, better than 50% on third down.
They have made their living on third downs here, as a matter of fact.
It's been so much fun today. Ivy League championship going to come down to this 4th and 9 play.
This is everything that we anticipated in terms of two offenses doing a great job putting points up on the board.
So Princeton's taking a timeout here to talk things over. What type of play do you like here, 4th and 9?
You know, I think you have to do what has worked for you, which is one of your two big receivers slanting in over the middle.
All right. Princeton going back out to the line of scrimmage. 4th and 9. Need the 35 to extend this game. Knauf has time. Now the pocket breaks down. Knauf throws an interception. Foye Oluokun across midfield, still on his feet, and down to the 35. The Bulldogs less than a minute away from clinching at least a share of the Ivy championship.
We had talked all game long about how successful that line, offensive line for Princeton had been keeping the defenders off of Chad Knauf. That time you got a combination. You got coverage downfield that took away any of his receivers, especially his two big receivers slanting over the middle, which we expected to see. Look at that. They're taken away over the middle. There's no place for him to go. And now finally you see that pressure from the defensive line.
Jack, Matthew Oplinger, the leader in sacks in the league, has been held without a sack today. But he got to the quarterback there to make the hit and force the tough throw. Princeton has just one timeout. Yale can take a couple of knees, and that'll lead to A whole lot of relief for Bulldog fans all around the country. The 11-year championship drought about to come to an end, and it'll set up a chance to win the outright Ivy Championship at the game next week at the Yale Bowl versus Harvard.
That shot right there gives you a sense of what Princeton's season has been. It started with such great promise, and it's ending for a lot of reasons with them once again on the short end of a score here. But it's a team that has fought valiantly. You look at what they did today and how shorthanded they were, especially on defense, and it was an exceptional effort by that Princeton defense.
Rawlings takes the first knee. He'll have to kneel once more. How about the gutsy effort from Zane Dudek? 35 carries, 180 yards, and three touchdowns. And Kurt Rawlings, the sophomore quarterback, as efficient as could be today. He completes 76% of his passes for 304 yards and two touchdowns.
Anybody who had a question about whether Zane Dudek was an every down back, I think he's answered that question.
One more knee to come. For the first time in 11 seasons, Yale clinches at least a share of the Ivy Championship. And for Team 145 at Yale, one more big game to come. Harvard next week for an outright title.
What you're seeing on the field is one of those great sportsmanship gestures. Both teams meeting at the field. Now, these are arch rivals. I'll go back to when I was playing, and you loved to beat Harvard. It was your rival, but you really loved to beat Princeton if you were a Yale player. And I think it works both ways. But if you look at this, a lot of these guys know each other, and you can tell there's great respect between both of these teams for the way they each played today.
Down 24-7, Yale rallies back to win this game, and now here are those Ivy League standings updated with in-progress games. Yale now 5-1. They can clinch the Ivy Championship outright with a win. This telecast by 11 Sports was granted with the expressed written consent of the Ivy League. And for Jack Ford, Seth Cantor, our entire crew, I'm Bill Spaulding.